Shall we all mute ourselves? Hi, Nikhil. Your background's different.
Doesn't matter. It's okay. Okay. Welcome everyone to this webinar today. And this webinar is going to be on cornea cases, walk-in cornea patient in your OPD. So how to diagnose such patients, how to treat such patients, and when to refer such patients. And I have with me a galaxy of speakers from all around the country. Dr. Mahipal Sachdev, who's the president of All India Ophthalmological Society, would be joining us soon. Then I have with me Dr. Rajesh Sinha, who's the treasurer of All India Ophthalmological Society from RP Center for Ophthalmic Sciences, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Then Dr. Rishi Mohan, who's the director of MMI Tech Institute, New Delhi. Then Dr. Jagdish Kumar Reddy, Director Shankara Eye Hospital from Coimbatore, Dr. Nikhil Gokhale, Consultant Gokhale Eye Hospital from Mumbai, and Dr. Meena Lakshmipathy, who's Senior Consultant from Shankar Netralay, Chennai. And we will begin this webinar now, and I would request Dr. Rajesh Sinha to give his talk on management of acute chemical injuries. This is an emergency which can present in any casualty or can present in any of the OPD. And it is important to know how we deal with such emergencies. Dr. Rajesh, please.
Thank you, Dr. Namita, for the opportunity. And I'll be talking about acute chemical injury. And as she told, that it is really a true ocular emergency because it has to be managed as early as possible and try to prevent the damage as far as possible. The common agents are alkalis and acids, and the acid injury causes less of damage because it causes denaturation of proteins. There is collagen shrinkage, so the penetration of the chemical is less. But in alkali, there is saponification of lipids in the cell membrane, and that leads to hydrolysis of the cell wall and causes deeper penetration. So the basic aim of management, as I said, that we should prevent the damage. And for that, we have to do a complete removal of chemical from the eye. And control of acute inflammatory reaction should be done. And you should prevent complications, something like this, to happen so that you don't end up in multiple interventions. And in spite of that, there can be suboptimal visual outcome. The prognosis depends not only on severity of injury, but also on the rapidity with which therapy is initiated. And that's why, as I said, that the prevention of sequelae is the key. And the management of acute chemical injury can be divided into immediate management, that you have to take care of the chemical that has come into the eye, and the early management, like you have to take care of the inflammation, etc. So the first aid or the immediate management is irrigation. Irrigation is done on an average for about 25 to 30 minutes. However, the time is not the guiding factor. The guiding factor is the pH, and the pH should return to normal. So pH paper should definitely be used. Only precaution one should do is that one should wait for 5 minutes once you have completely stopped the irrigation, and then do check the pH, because otherwise it will show the pH of the irrigating solution, the washing solution that you are being used. Now, washing can be done by anything. I mean, if the chemical is gone, one should immediately look at the nearby tap and can wash it with tap water as far as possible, and then report to any hospital wherein the thorough wash can be done by averting the lids, etc., so that you can remove the chemical completely. So that is the basic aim, and the final aim is to attain the pH of 7.3, 7.4, close to that. Now, one should definitely try to do double eversion of lids. Sometimes what happens is the chemical goes into the fornices and gets stuck there. So double eversion of lid should be done, and the patient should be asked to look down so that the fornices can be seen and one can remove the particulate matter from that area. As I said, there are various ways of removing the chemical. Even the tap water can be used. And the best solution that has been shown in literature is balanced salt solution, BSS plus. However, Ringer lactate is also very good, and that is available everywhere in any emergency situation. Then once the epithelium, once the chemical has been removed by washing and by checking the pH and after double eversion, remove the particulate matter, we should see how much is the damage. So the basic idea is to promote epithelialization, support repair and minimize ulceration and control inflammation. So for that, the assessment of severity should be done. It is very essential to assess the severity by checking the size of epithelial defect and also checking the limbal ischemia, and so that it is not just theoretical, rather it gives you an idea that what all you have to do. The management differs with different grades, and you can also explain the prognosis to the patient. This is the old classification, or I would say the gold standard classification of chemical injury. That was the Roper Hall classification, which divided into four grades of chemical injury. The fourth grade had more than half of limbal ischemia. Now, more than half can have various variable prognosis. Somebody can have 200 degrees of ischemia. Somebody can have 360 degree ischemia. So the prognosis was very variable. And that is what has been done in Dua's classification. They have classified the fourth group into three parts. And that is how they could explain the prognosis better, and the management pattern differs with this. And this is one study from our center which states that the Dua's classification is better in terms of explaining the prognosis to the patient. Once the damage has been assessed, then what we should do is we should debride the necrotic material. Then the patient is given some medication to reduce the symptoms, analgesic, topical antibiotics, lubrication is given, cycloplegics, and topical steroids should be given. Apart from that, depending upon the severity of injury, if the injury is more, there is some stromal involvement, then in that case, it is very essential to prevent damage to the collagen, the stromal collagen. And for that, ascorbate and citrate are very useful. Now, ascorbate acts as a cofactor, which helps in collagen synthesis, and citrate prevents the collection of polymorphs. So the release of collagenase is stopped by inhibiting the polymorphs by sodium citrate, and thereby it prevents the damage to the corneal stroma. And the same way, doxycycline is also used as a collagenase inhibitor to prevent damage to the stromal collagen. And systemic sodium ascorbate is given 1 gram twice a day, or 500 milligram 4 times a day, whatever you feel like. Autologous serum has been found to be quite effective in severe cases. And there's one study done under the guidance of Dr. Namita Sharma at RP Center, wherein it was compared umbilical cord serum and the autologous serum was compared, and they found that the umbilical cord serum was even better than autologous serum. Now, sometimes what you see that the particulate matter has gone in deep underneath the conjunctiva. So in that case, you cannot leave any particulate matter, because that will not only cause the persistent damage, it will cause more and more episcleral ischemia, then scleral ischemia, and scleral melting, all sorts of things can happen. So it is very essential to remove the particulate matter, even by going underneath the conjunctiva, remove all these the chemical agent from underneath. And then once you have done it, then you can put an amniotic membrane over the surface and it will heal. Amniotic membrane has been found to be quite effective. It not only aids in epithelial defect, it provides symptomatic relief in the patient. There was one study done at our center which showed that the amniotic membrane is really useful, not only in improving epithelialization in cases of chemical injury, but also it reduces inflammation and it reduces pain in the patient. So amniotic membrane at a period, maybe at around 7 or 10 days time, or sometimes when you see that the epithelium is not healing, in that case, amniotic membrane can be used. As I said, topical steroid can be used for, you know, 10 days or maybe extended up to 14 days. Sometimes what happens is the inflammation is quite severe. In that case, and the epithelium is not healing, then you can use amniotic membrane and also put topical steroid for another week or so. And that is how you actually, you know, titrate your mask depending upon the severity of the patient. And this is one patient where an amniotic membrane graft was done and the epithelial healing and the stromal clarity improved. This is one study which I was talking about. Dr. Amol Tamane was the resident who had done the thesis at RP Center, and they found out that amniotic membrane transplantation in acute chemical burns as an early therapy done at between 10 to 14 days time after the injury improved epithelialization, reduced pain and reduced symptom of the patient, reduced inflammation. And there are various studies which have shown that amniotic membrane transplantation is quite effective in early improvement of the cases of chemical injury. Apart from that, conjunctival advancement or tenonplasty or multilayered AMG can be done if there is any stromal melting. Now, tenonplasty has shown in cases of scleral ischemia and cases of the ischemia which is quite severe, the AP scleral and the scleral ischemia. In that case, tenonplasty, a pedicle graft of tenon, really helps in vascularization of that area and prevents the scleral melting. So, to end my discussion about the management of acute chemical injury, there are certain things that we should think about. As the theme of the symposium is to give take-home message to the delegates on three points, on three parameters. One is how to diagnose. So as far as chemical injury is concerned, there will be a definitive history of injury by chemical. Then the patient will have symptoms like pain, redness, photophobia, and blurring. And then you will be seeing the corneal epithelial haze. There can be defect, there can be stromal haze, and there can be limbal ischemia. And based on all these, you can easily diagnose. And of course, the 99% of the patient will be telling you about the history of chemical injury. As far as treatment is concerned, it depends on the severity of chemical injury. Suppose somebody has a very mild chemical injury, grade one injury. In that case, you can just put lubricant, topical steroid, and epithelial friendly antibiotic prophylaxis, say something like chloramphenicol, etc., whatever. And then the patient will have a nice clearing of the whatever epithelial haze is there, and that will go off. As the severity increases, once it goes to grade two, grade three, you add more things like topical steroid. Of course, you have to give ascorbate, citrate, and doxycycline is given. And in further severe injuries, you can do all these tenonplasty or autologous serum and amniotic membrane transplantation can be done in cases once it is more severe and not resolving. But the most important thing that I would like to highlight is to remove the chemical from the eye. That can be done in any setting, even in a village, that can be done because it can be washed off even with the tap water. So that is most important. You should you should remove the chemical from the eye by saline wash. Check the pH, if the pH paper is available, and try to avert the lids and see if there is particulate matter that should be removed. And if once you have done the immediate management and the early management, then if you see that the patient is having marked epithelial defect or the stromal haze and significant limbal ischemia, wherein you have doubt that there will be AP scleral ischemia, there can be even scleral melts, etc., or there can be corneal melts, or the patient is having secondary glaucoma because chemical can cause damage to the trabecular meshwork and that can lead to secondary glaucoma, or there is a symblephron formation because of the conjunctival damage or conjunctivalization of cornea. In all these situations, one should definitely refer the patient to a specialist, cornea specialist, who can handle such cases in a more specialized and focused manner. So thank you very much for your patient listening. Now we have the next speaker. There is Dr. Namrata Sharma. I would like to invite her for her presentation.
Thank you, Rajesh. I would be talking to you about adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis diagnosis and management. And we all will agree that this can become sometimes very tricky to treat. There are no financial disclosures, and it is the most common cause of red eye in the world and constitutes about 15 to 70% of all conjunctivitis. Basically, there are 60 serotypes present, which are divided into six groups, and it can occur as epidemic keratoconjunctivitis, pharyngoconjunctival fever, or as non-specific follicular conjunctivitis. Now, generally, the age group is 20 to 40 years, and pharyngoconjunctival fever occurs most commonly in children and is highly contagious because of direct contact with ocular secretions. But spread can occur also generally from the contact with eye care providers, instruments, tonometers, lid specula, slit lamps, etc. And nowadays, any viral conjunctivitis has become so important because of the COVID times. There are seven species which are involved, and each of these species is linked to a particular kind of clinical manifestation. So serotype 8, 19, and 37 are responsible for EKC, and serotype 3, 5, 7, and 11 are responsible for the pharyngoconjunctival fever. Now, the incubation period is generally 4 to 24 days. Symptoms tend to last for 7 to 21 days, pretty much like the corona. Patient remains infectious for 2 to 3 weeks, predominantly unilateral, involves the fellow eye in almost 70% of the cases. And there may be recent history of eye exam, affected family member, or occupational exposure. It has a biphasic clinical course, so there can be initial infective phase and inflammatory phase, which is 7 to 10 days after the initial infection. The patients may complain of excessive watering, foreign body sensation, photophobia, and decreased visual acuity. And the signs are variable. There could be crusting and swelling of the eyelids with bulbar conjunctival injection, conjunctival chemosis, follicular or papillary reaction may be there with subconjunctival hemorrhages, and follicular reaction of the inferior tarsal conjunctiva may also be seen. Now, it tends to have a self-limiting course, but sometimes it doesn't heal. And in those cases, there can be complications such as petechial and subconjunctival hemorrhages, pseudomembranes, which can form, true membranes can also form, subepithelial infiltrates, similar frond formation, and there can be superadded bacterial infection. We have to differentiate between the pseudomembranes and the membranes. So these are the pseudomembranes, which are classically sheets of fibrin-rich exudate, which do not have any blood or lymphatic vessels, and they consist of conglomerate of WBC, macrophages, etc. And when you remove this, there will be no bleeding. So that is why they are pseudo in nature. True membranes, on the other hand, is when there's a coagulum which is present beneath the epithelium and there's early angiogenesis. And when you remove them, there'll be classically bleeding, which will be there. And this may cause subepithelial fibrosis and similar frond formation. Now, once the adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis, the acute phase is over, it can then go on to the chronic phase where you have multifocal subepithelial infiltrates, which are seen in almost half of the cases, more frequently in serotype 8. And they're about 0.5 to 1 millimeter oval to round in superficial cornea. They may appear from fourth day onwards and may be there chronically for months or even up to years. And they are generally few or 10 to 15 number. And patients would complain of photophobia, glare, and decrease in the best corrected visual acuity. And they represent cellular immune reaction against viral antigens, which are deposited on the corneal stroma under the Bowman's membrane. Bacterial superinfection can occur. This is rarely seen and more seen in children. And this can lead to amblyopia and strabismus. And pathogens which commonly include are the gram-positive cocci, especially the strep pyogenes and the gram-negative rods. Now, best these cases are generally diagnosed clinically, although lab investigations have been indicated in case of atypical presentations or when the strain responsible, when there's an epidemic and you want to know what is the strain responsible for EKC. And this is generally seen in the current months, that is around July to August. And when the disease is recurrent and when there is no response to conventional treatment. So although the tests are cumbersome, but more recently the rapid adenodetector test is the one which has come into vogue, which is a very quick test. The sensitivity is 88%, specificity is 91%. And it picks up, there are 53 serotypes it detects within just 10 minutes. Although also you can do PCR in these cases in viral cultures, and serology ELISA, which is positive in 85% of the cases, which is done more for research purposes than for diagnosis clinically. Then the differential diagnosis consists of HSV and HCV conjunctivitis, chlamydial or bacterial conjunctivitis, allergic conjunctivitis, chemical conjunctivitis. Then it can be also related to contact lenses and foreign body, which may be there. Now, the first line of treatment for acute cases as shown, so the disease is self-limited and resolution generally occurs within 3 weeks. So for symptomatic cases, the conservative treatment that is given is cold packs, artificial lubricants 8 to 10 times a day. Topical antibiotics may be given just to prevent or treat superadded bacterial infection 3 to 4 times a day. And topical antihistamines and vasoconstrictors can reduce the discomfort. The topical steroids have a role to play, although it is controversial in acute phase. They may have a transient alleviating effect and may give symptomatic relief. But they are generally reserved for cases where when there are pseudomembranes, subepithelial infiltrates in the visual axis, and the visual axis is significantly impaired, and severely symptomatic cases in terms of photophobia, foreign body sensation. So you would give topical steroids in these cases where there are membranes, where the patient is severely photophobic and symptomatic, or where there are multiple subepithelial infiltrates, because you don't want them to scar. Because if they scar, then they will cause a decrease in the best corrected visual acuity. Now the problems are that early cases of HSV, fungal and acanthamoeba keratitis may be confused with this, and then you can be in a problem. And it also increases the adenovirus replication rate as well as viral shedding. There may be dependence on the steroids. So the subepithelial infiltrates will reappear again on tapering of the steroids. And long-term use can also cause a risk of cataract and glaucoma. Now, this is a trial which was done way back in 2011, where they looked at 111 patients who were randomized either to receive dexamethasone 0.1% or hypermellose. And this study concluded that it does shorten the course of the disease. And there were no harmful effects which were seen in this cohort of patients. And there's always a question as to which steroid to use. Lopinavir, that means a low dose, a low potent steroid, or a steroid such as dexamethasone. Now, again, this study compared these two entities, lopinavir 0.5% and dexamethasone 0.1%. And in terms of the outcomes, there was no difference. And so they concluded that one should use the strongest steroid with these side effects for adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis treatment. And again, povidone iodine is something which is also come into vogue for adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis. And a combination is being studied, topical povidone iodine along with 0.1% dexamethasone. So that topical steroids, they relieve the symptoms, and the povidone iodine kills the virus in the tears and decreases the risk of the disease spread. Now this was a RCT which was done, which compared 0.1% dexamethasone and povidone iodine versus placebo. And again, they concluded that dexa-povidone combination does shorten the duration of conjunctivitis, but it reported more stinging. And this was a prospective randomized control study of 78 eyes, which looked into three groups. And again, concluded that the fastest improvement in the signs and symptoms occurred when povidone was combined with dexamethasone 0.1%. And when only lubricating agents were used, there was lowest improvement in the signs and the symptoms. So combination treatment reduced the symptoms and expedited the recovery in the EKC patients. Now, again, the topical povidone iodine has also come into vogue because of the corona times, and it is virucidal. It does not increase the viral shedding. It kills 99% of even bacteria, MRSA, Pseudomonas, Serratia, and Candida. And in vitro virucidal activity has also been shown against herpes simplex virus. Now, in cases which do not respond to these, topical cyclosporin can be given. And this is given in 1% and 2% concentrations. It is a calcineurin pathway inhibitor and a steroid-sparing agent, and given in symptomatic patients which are not responding to steroids. Of course, and when there are steroid side effects in the form of raised intraocular pressure and cataract formation. Then topical cyclosporin again reduces the formation of the subepithelial infiltrates, foreign body sensation and visual improvement, as was seen in studies which have looked into topical cyclosporin concentrations ranging from 0.5 to 2%. And Ocumus et al. Also have found that topical cyclosporin 0.05%, that is Restasis, is safe and effective alternative in patients which are not responsive to steroids. Then in those cases which are not responding to topical steroids, you can even give topical tacrolimus. Both the eye drop 0.03% and the ointment 0.02% have been tried and have given good results. Recently, there were publications in Indian Journal of Ophthalmology which looked into the efficacy of the ointment and said that probably it was better than the eye drops. People have even tried topical antivirals, but I don't think they actually have a role to play. Cidofovir 1% has been tried 4 to 10 times a day, and although it did decrease corneal opacities, but local toxicity was higher in the form of pseudomembrane development and lacrimal duct stenosis. Then for the sub haze that occurs because of the subepithelial infiltrates, even PTK has been done with mitomycin C, which is supposed to improve visual acuity, photophobia, and contrast sensitivity. And of course, prevention is better than cure. So good hygiene practices are a must. Rigorous disinfection of hands and instruments should be done, especially in the eye clinics, and minimize the contact with the infected tissue. And all instruments and surfaces have to be cleaned with 70% ethyl alcohol or 5% sodium hypochlorite solution, and reduce the transmission through the gloves, the tonometer heads. Single eye patient eye drop dispensers should also be used for the same. So to conclude, adenoviral conjunctivitis is a self-limiting disease that tends to resolve spontaneously within 1 to 3 weeks in most cases. Management is focused on symptomatic relief, and topical steroids may be indicated if vision-threatening complications arise. Late scarring may be treated by PTK, and of course, prevention is important to control propagation of infection. Now, how to diagnose, treat, and refer, the theme of this webinar. So the acute phase generally tends to resolve, and so does the symptoms in the form of pain, foreign body sensation, photophobia, etc., by conservative treatment. The problem comes when there are subepithelial infiltrates present, or pseudomembranes, or membranes which are present. In all such cases, the first line of treatment would be lubricants. Whenever there are complications, topical steroids can be added. And if after withdrawal of the topical steroids, the recurrence of the symptoms do occur, then topical cyclosporin can be added to it, followed by slow withdrawal of the topical steroids. And then if it doesn't work, then as the third line of treatment, topical tacrolimus can be added. Suffice it to say that if the cases are recurrent and not getting treated, then it is best to refer these cases to the cornea specialists who would be more experienced in treating such cases. So thank you very much for your kind attention. And if there are any questions, I think we can take them after Nikhil's talk, because we would then cover the allergic type of keratoconjunctivitis.
Thank you, Dr. Namrata. And now we would like to invite Dr. Nikhil Gokhale, who will be talking on allergic conjunctivitis.
Yeah, thank you. Just a second, just share. You can see my slide.
Yeah, it's there.
Yeah. So I thank Dr. Namrata giving me this opportunity, and I'll just share with you some of my about how we should be managing patients with VKC, which is a very severe condition that we see in our day-to-day practice and very difficult to treat. I think the allergies are globally increasing, as well as in India, we see a lot of early age pediatric VKC, and we see very chronic patients who have very severe disease. Often there may be associated atopy. And one of the extra problem that we have in our country is that patients tend to self-medicate with steroids, which can create more complications in the long term. There may be various factors like genetic factors, environmental, hygiene related and nutritional factors, which may be causing an increase in allergy globally. Management options which can target various molecules and cytokines in the chain of the allergy. However, steroids somehow are used more often, and often the patients tend to use them on their own and get into more complications. So the limitations that we have presently are, one is that we don't have proper grading systems and management algorithms or flow charts. And also the patients may have unrealistic expectations because of inadequate counseling that we sometimes get into. And therefore, the problem that we face is that if we over-treat our patients, we may have side effects, whereas if we under-treat our patients and we are not adequately controlling inflammation, we are going to have tissue damage. Very often what happens in a general ophthalmic clinic is to prescribe a tapering schedule of steroid drops for 4 weeks. The patient does get better, but often there is a recurrence and the same course may be repeated, or sometimes the patient goes to another eye surgeon where the same course is again repeated, and eventually the patient gets frustrated. So I think what we need to do in our practice is really to try and evaluate what type of disease we are seeing, what how severe it is, how periodicity is there, how many recurrences are there. And based on that, we need to counsel the patient, set up the expectations, and then look at how we can manage the inflammation on a long-term basis, and which would be safe so that we are able to control the disease as well as reduce the number of side effects of the medications. We require a system by which we can grade the disease at each visit, and therefore decide what would be the best treatment strategy and modify our treatment accordingly. So we could grade disease as maybe very mild disease. We know when there is just some signs in the conjunctiva with few symptoms, no really corneal involvement is there. And then we have more moderate disease where you'll have early corneal involvement. A severe form of allergy could be where you have more severe signs which involve the cornea. We know that is what threatens the vision, and we are scared of getting corneal complications. And then we could reach a stage where there are irreversible corneal damage may happen. These may be cases who have recurrent shield ulcers or limbal deficiency. These could be the blinding varieties of disease. And we may also have a burnt out allergy, which may present like an ocular surface disease or a dry eye, which is again needs a little different way of management. We also need to distinguish whether we are looking at a disease which is chronic, going on for 365 days, or which is intermittent with few episodes, maybe once in 2 or 3 months, and accordingly decide what would be the best management lines. Not to over-medicate, so patients with mild disease can usually be managed with lubricants, antihistaminics, and mast cell stabilizers. And when we look at a moderate or early corneal involvement, you can use mild steroids, which will be good if the disease is intermittent. However, when we have more chronic forms or more severe forms of disease, we will have to try and use steroid-sparing agents as a first line of management, along with low-dose topical steroids, which may be preferably surface-acting steroids. But we will require more potent steroids in patients with very severe disease. We may require to give them supratarsal injection of steroids and potent steroid drops in addition to the steroid-sparing calcineurin inhibitors that we would like to use. Also, in extremely severe forms of disease, which may be blinding varieties of VKC, we may require to use systemic immunosuppression. I think one strategy which we have not used very often in the past is allergy testing and immunotherapy. And I think this is something which holds promise. Only thing is it requires 3 to 5 years of prolonged treatment, but can basically change the natural course of allergic disease. So we need to treat our patients in a stepladder pattern, try to grade them at every visit, and then try to go up the ladder if the inflammation is not getting controlled. And once the inflammation is under control, either because of the medication or because the natural allergy process wanes and waxes, as we know, we can go down the ladder and try to use more safer medications and less potent medications to control or keep the disease under adequate control. Therefore, using a grading system so that we can grade the severity and accordingly adjust the treatment in a stepladder fashion will help us to over or under medicate our patients. So we need to optimally medicate so that the side effects of under and over treatment are balanced. And this would be very safe for long-term management in our patients. Just a little bit of a busy slide here, but I'll just tell you, as a general ophthalmologist, often the people ask, like a patient coming to clinic, how would you try to analyze and manage? So I think it's very essential, because most of the patients often have gone to several other ophthalmologists, taken a lot of previous treatment. You look at all records, look at the medications used, what has been the response to the treatment, and based on that, you can decide what type of case you're treating, and then accordingly decide the next line of management. For example, a child who has used surface steroids and has had a good response to treatment, and however there is a recurrence within a very few weeks, maybe, or within 2 to 4 weeks of treatment, probably has a moderate grade of chronic VKC. However, a child which then the eye doesn't require medication for 2 or 3 months may be having an intermittent periodicity VKC of a moderate grade. A child where the surface steroids don't give an adequate response, which you can often know from the history, may be a chronic VKC of a moderate grade. However, children who are extremely photophobic and they have a lot of symptoms despite using surface steroids, we are probably looking at a more severe form of disease. And those who have previously used potent steroids, if they had good response, again, we need to see if it's recurring. As soon as the steroids are tapering, it's a chronic disease, whereas if the response is maintained and the remission is maintained for a long period of time, probably it's an intermittent periodicity disease. So based on this, then we can decide what would be the best line to start treatment and follow up these children. There are some questions which often come into our mind is oral antihistaminics. Well, we would use them only if there are significant systemic allergies associated. Oral leukotriene inhibitors have limited benefit. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drops are best avoided if there is corneal epithelial damage, because they may increase toxicity and predispose to more complications. In children who have severe rhinitis, nasal steroids would be useful. Lubricants are always useful to flush out the allergens, and because there is often an associated dry eye and surface inflammation, which tends to get better when you use lubricants. And cold compresses are very effective to reduce itching in a small child. Of course, we need to stress on hygiene and avoidance measures, and to use some sort of a protective goggles need to be used. Dual acting agents such as olopatadine, azelastine, quetotifen, these are the drugs which we often use today, and they are extremely effective in seasonal allergies or very mild allergies. However, when we look at VKC, we know it's an immune-mediated disease where they are supportive in their role. However, we need to definitely use immunosuppressive agents. And I think the best agents that we have today are steroids, which you can use for limbal disease as drops. And sometimes for severe tarsal disease, you can use supratarsal injections as well. However, we need to understand that they have their own set of side effects. So we can use them in acute episodes when the child has severe VKC. And it's always good to use them in a pulsed approach. And when we are looking at long-term maintenance therapy, probably once we use calcineurin inhibitors, we can use steroids as a low dose maintenance can be given. Always try and use soft steroids, and always we try to monitor the usage and see that the patient does not misuse or self use steroid and they disappear from your follow-up protocols. We also need to understand that the steroid response may be higher in children, and there is a propensity which may be there to develop cataract, which may be difficult to monitor in extremely photophobic children. So if we encounter extremely small children with severe inflammation, or children who already have a steroid response which is documented, or a lens change is documented, I think we have to be very cautious of further continuing the steroid usage. Cyclosporine is a very good steroid sparing agent, which can be used in extremely mild cases. We can use commercial cyclosporine. However, in most cases of VKC, we would require to formulate the cyclosporine about strength of 0.5 to 2%. We can formulate it using a lubricant drop and dilute the injectable preparation of cyclosporine, or we can also use orosporine. I have no financial interest, but it is also available as 2%, which can be used either directly or can be diluted to a lower concentration, which improves its tolerance levels. And cyclosporine has been shown way back 25 years back that it is stable in artificial tears and it works well as a preparation. So the cyclosporine, as we know, is a steroid sparing agent. We can use it safely for a very long period of time because the allergy in general tends to go on chronically in these severe cases for a very long period of time. And it has been reported to be used up to even 7 years of treatment. Tacrolimus is now commercially available. It is similar to cyclosporine. It has the convenience of being available on the market shelf, unlike you require to prepare a cyclosporine at a higher concentration. However, the tolerance with tacrolimus again is an issue, and you can use it over the lids or inside the eye depending on the tolerance that the child has. And in severe cases, when you have patients with shield ulcer, if the shield ulcer has a clear base very early on, if you are able to diagnose, you can just use a steroid and an antibiotic drop to aid the suppression of allergy and heal the ulcer. However, once the ulcer base is more opalescent, you need to debride the overlying surface to get a clear base, because this is where there is a deposition of eosinophilic material which prevents epithelial sliding. And sometimes you may need to combine this with a supratarsal steroid injections. And when we have patients who have extremely severe plaque formation, we need to excise the plaque and debride the surface. And then in rare situations, if the ulcer doesn't still heal, you might have to require doing an amniotic membrane graft or give oral steroids. It's very essential that when you look at a shield ulcer, always rule out infection. And for that, you need to look at anterior chamber reaction, presence of any focal infiltrates. And whenever there is doubt, it is better to scrape, because once you give steroids, the infection can really go for a toss. It's very rare that systemic immunosuppression is required in children with VKC. However, for a short-term period, we know systemic steroids are safe and can be used. But if we are looking at a long-term management, systemic cyclosporine is very much more safer and effective. So when you treat appropriately, I think probably it's a rare situation that you need a systemic treatment. You may require systemic steroid in an emergency situation. For example, you get a large shield ulcer in a poorly managed VKC. No previous treatment has been taken adequately. You might bridge the gap with a systemic steroid. Similarly, you can get very severe blinding disease where you may use oral cyclosporine to sort of control the disease so that we don't get into more complications. Similarly, if you do a reconstructive surgery on the ocular surface, you may need to systemically immunosuppress some of these children. So it is very rare. However, it is something that we may require in our armamentarium at time. There are some of these cases where you may require systemic cyclosporine, and this can be sight saving and vision saving, and may be very effective in some of these children. Surgical management of giant cobblestones has also been mentioned by using either oral amniotic oral mucous membrane or an amniotic membrane graft, may be used again in very serious refractory cases which don't respond to treatment. Ancillary management may be required to treat the complications that happen when you have a chronic VKC, and which is itself a separate chapter. And I think after doing all that, we need to understand that there are several avoidance measures which is ophthalmologists, we need to remember and try to spend some time and guide our patients so that we can reduce the exposure to allergens and help these children require less number of medications. Thank you.
Thank you, Nikhil, for that wonderful presentation. Every time I hear this presentation, I, you know, learn 4 or 5 more additional things. It is so comprehensive and so complete. I'm sure we do have a lot of questions on this. After Dr. Meena Lakshmapati's talk, we will take the questions which are coming on the webpage. I now invite Dr. Meena to give her talk on bacterial keratitis. Dr. Meena. She's going to be speaking on bacterial keratitis and resistance, the way to go.
Dr. Namrata, is my slide seen?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for having me here. I'm going to talk about bacterial keratitis. It's a little bit also resistance. And basically this webinar is for patients who come to your OPD. So It's going to be basically a little how to deal with bacterial keratitis. So Dr. Srinivasan has given a very good editorial in the 2007 IJO edition of the, of introducing a term called silent epidemic. It's very important in this time of pandemic epidemic that we do not forget that there is already a silent epidemic that we are fighting day in and out. It's very important because it's considered an ocular emergency. At this moment, there are probably 6.8 million people who are unilaterally blind, and every year 1.5 to 2 million people are added to the corneal blindness. And corneal blindness, you remember, is only second to cataract blindness. Of the corneal ulcerations, 65% are non-viral, meaning majority are we are dealing with either bacterial or fungal keratitis. A little bit, you need to know what are the most common causes of bacterial keratitis, but they seem to be the most common prevalent bacterial keratitis is Staphylococcus epidermis. And in the south of India, in some of the groups, they have reported Streptococcus pneumoniae. Basic features that you need to know about the ulcer and its workup is to see where the location is, whether there are any risk factors, whether you are having a microbiological workup facility, and you need to understand something about the antibiotic coverage that you are choosing to start. Why are bacterial keratitis important or common is the most common cause of bacterial keratitis remains trauma, and the fewer causes are because of contact lenses, post-surgery, and very rarely because of immunosuppression. Remember, there are some bacteria which are mentioned below that can overcome the ocular defense mechanism in the sense that in the presence of intact epithelium, they can penetrate the cornea. So the suppurative kind of bacterial keratitis, which are very dangerous, are the Staphylococcus, the Streptococcus, and the Pseudomonas. So these are the predisposing factors which are illustrated here, which I've already mentioned. The most important is the epithelial defect. Look for whether there's any underlying band-shaped keratopathy. Look for lid margin disease, and if there's underlying compromised cornea like bullous keratopathy, if there has been a foreign body removed, if there's any ocular surface problem like keratoconjunctivitis sicca, and just as you heard Dr. Namrata speak, in viral keratitis, she has never mentioned the use of topical antibiotics. If the patient has been using chronically some kind of steroid or topical antibiotics, he could develop some surface disorders and predispose to bacterial keratitis. These are some of the other causes. In never forget that the use of harmful native medications can cause severe infections like Pseudomonas in the eye. Before you start up the workup, you need to remember what are the differences between bacterial and fungal. Bacterial typically is acute and fungal is subacute, meaning they come around 2 to 4 weeks. But there is no clear-cut difference exactly. But just remember, fungal can have a dry, wet, dry surface, and they tend to have a lot of satellites and endothelial exudates, but the bacterial has a lot of stromal edema and they have a well-defined borders, whereas the fungal keratitis has a hyphate edges. So whatever the kind of or infection that you're going to see depends upon the virulence of the organism, meaning you already know that Staphylococcus, Streptococcus, and Pseudomonas are highly virulent. So these are going to have an acute onset. Whether it was post-traumatic, whether it was a deeper way of inoculation, that means again, they could be very severe. What was the status of the underlying cornea and whether there was any risk factors and the host mechanism such as any immunocompromised state. So you need to take a proper history about the risk factors and you have to properly document, measure the size of the infiltrate vertically and horizontally, measure both the epithelial defect and the stromal infiltrate, and ask your lab to help you with your staining methods and subject the specimen to culture and in vitro susceptibility tests. So coming on to gram-positive cocci typically cause a localized infiltrate with the minimal surrounding edema, especially if it's Staphylococcus epidermidis. But whereas if it's Staphylococcus aureus, which is the most suppurative variety of the Staphylococcus, it has very edematous surrounding, which a large endo-exudate sometimes underlying, and sometimes they can have a deeper stromal infiltrate, something like an endothelial plaque. Remember, this is very suppurative. They present with an acute onset. The other acute presenting infiltrate from gram-positive organism is the Streptococcus pneumoniae, which can sometimes be seen in those patients who have dacrocystitis. So this has a description called a serpiginous ulcer, where there's one edge which is active and keeps leading towards the center of the cornea, and the edge which is posterior starts resolving and sometimes thinning. There is a lot of fibrin and hypapion also in these cases. Among the gram-positive bacilli, which can be very virulent, is the Bacillus cereus. sometimes seen after trauma, and if it can present like a ring infiltrate and can progress to endophthalmitis. Not so acute, but rarely the gram-positive bacilli, which are acid fast, are due to atypical mycobacteria. These are seen typically after vegetable matter injury or soil, and they have something known as cracked windshield appearance, which means that different levels of the stroma are affected, and they have something like hyphate edges, and they sometimes can be thought about as a fungal keratitis. Again, not so acute are Nocardia species, which can cause a pinpoint infiltrates with a central epithelial defect, causing a characteristic reach-shaped like infiltrate. And these do not come in the acute phase, but somewhere around 2 to 3 weeks. And these can sometimes be thought about as fungal keratitis. Among the most virulent gram-negative bacilli is the Pseudomonas aeruginosa, which is resistant to multiple chemicals. So they can be seen as a nosocomial infection, and sometimes they can be seen in the drops that the patients carry also. This is because the bacteria has multiple resistant factors. And in India, the contact lens-induced keratitis is most commonly Pseudomonas aeruginosa and not acanthamoeba. And this is how it presents. It presents very acutely. There's a lot of chemosis and there's a lot of discharge in these patients. And very quickly, it can perforate and cause desmetocele and needs an urgent keratoplasty. So you need to identify some of the typical clinical features of the patients that you walk in, whether these are acute or chronic. If they are chronic, they're non-healing or non-responding to the medications given, whether these are after any special conditions like post-LASIK, or if they are after a tunnel infection after SICS or FACO, or if they're post-LASIK conditions, you need to identify the underlying status of the cornea. Subject the material to grams and KOH. The advantage of grams is it's a quick method, but the disadvantage is it's specific only in 40 to 60%. If it is atypical organisms, you need to do acid fast staining, and you need to subject the specimen for culture methods. Culture methods are typically available somewhere between 48 to 72 hours, and you need to wait at least 2 weeks for the entire report to come. Very rarely we do PCR and confocal for these tests. If the specimen is very deep and you're not able to procure the specimen, you may have to do a biopsy and subject it to histopathology. So this is how a gram-positive organism appears. They appear as purple organisms, and the gram-negative is seen as pinkish structures. We never take conjunctival or lid specimens for culturing, and we always do a C-strip for the corneal specimen and look for the growth of the bacteria. If it's a small ulcer like seen below and it's away from the visual axis, we generally tend to start the patient on fourth generation fluoroquinolones, which are broad spectrum agents. If there's only an epithelial defect and no infiltrates, it's safe to start chloramphenicol eye drops or chloramphenicol eye ointment. If you see a small ulcer with a very rapid onset, you have to treat it as an emergency. Again, if it is more than 2 millimeters, it's central and large, you have to subject this specimen for smear and culture, and start the patient ideally on fortified cephalosporins, which is cefazolin, with an aminoglycosides, which will give a coverage for both the positive and the negative organisms. So generally, if you get a gram-positive cocci on your smear, you start the patient on cefazolin, or if you are unable to procure the cephalosporins, it is safe to start the fourth-generation fluoroquinolones. If you identify there is some resistance to treatment, in the sense the patient is not responding, you have to look at your in vitro lab reports, and if available, start the patient on linezolid and vancomycin or vancomycin. For gram-negative bacilli, it's safe to start the patient on fortified aminoglycosides because they give a very good coverage. And if that's not available, you could start on the fourth-generation fluoroquinolones. If there is resistance to this tobramycin, amikacin seems to do very well, and that's what we start for our patients. The second line of therapy is fortified ceftazidime, which is the third generation cephalosporin, and piperacillin, meropenem, and colistin is for multi-drug resistant organisms like in Pseudomonas and Burkholderia, and this is a real emergency. For gram-positive bacilli like the acid-fast bacteria, fortified amikacin and the fourth generation fluoroquinolones can give a good coverage. Clarithromycin, oral clarithromycin, generally given for atypical mycobacteria. So the risk factors for drug resistance is what we are concerned with, is because of repeated antibiotic use, if there's an ocular surface problem, if there has been recent hospitalization, if the patient has had any surgical interventions or infections, or if the person is a medical personnel and if this is a chronic keratitis. The generations of fluoroquinolones that are used for treatment of keratitis are usually the third generation or the fourth generation. The fourth generation have the advantage that they are useful for the expanded gram-positive organism that are not covered by the second generation. And they're also useful for Streptococcus pneumoniae and the atypical mycobacterial cases, which are not covered by the third and the second generation fluoroquinolones. The advantages are they're easily available over the counter. They are broad spectrum. They have very good penetration. They're highly concentrated in the tissues, and they can sometimes be used and combined with cephalosporins. A little bit about the pharmacological action of the fluoroquinolones is that they have a low MIC level, meaning the minimum inhibitory concentration, which prevents the growth of the bacteria, is low when studied in vitro, and they achieve a very high concentration in the specimen. So the area below the concentration, the difference between the Cmax level and the MIC, because it's very wide in these drugs, a lot of organisms actually get inhibited. There's one more concept which we are working on at this time is the mutant prevention concentration, which is the area above the mutant prevention concentration, which prevents the appearance of the first mutants in this organisms. And this again is the concept of the fourth generation, which prevents the first step mutants to occur. So mechanism of resistance is that the first step mutations are occurring in the DNA gyrase and the topoisomerase. The second step mutation occurs on the efflux mechanisms or the permeability mechanisms, or sometimes on chromosomal mutation and horizontal plasmid transfer. So the mutant prevention concentration reaches a concentration by this fourth generation fluoroquinolones, which prevents the mutation at the DNA gyrase or the topoisomerase. And these are some of the reasons of widespread resistance which are occurring at this time. And we need to at least initiate frequent therapy of these fluoroquinolones or topical antibiotics at frequent topicals. Do not continue a prolonged low dose frequency, which can cause mutants to occur, and restrict the use of topical antibiotics in viral conjunctivitis. So when do you refer a patient? When it is post-surgical, like you see in a post-optical graft or a therapeutic graft, there's a large staphylococcus abscess sitting there. When it is post-trauma and when there is an impending perforation, and other conditions like post-LASIK and post-SICS phaco-tunnel injury, these are considered as emergency because they can lead to endophthalmitis. So my first take-home message is, you need to have a good, appropriate history to help you understand what could be the underlying cause, document the ulcer, assess the severity, and subject adequate samples to microbiology. And when necessary, repeat if you are in doubt. The second take-home message is, if it is less than 2 millimeter, you can start empirical therapy. Especially now, when there is a difficulty in finding a compounding facility, you may have to start on fourth generation fluoroquinolones. If it's a large central infiltrate, you need to start on fortified cephalosporins, if needed, fortified aminoglycosides. Change according to the response, what you see. It's not always necessary to change if you get in vitro resistance, because in vitro resistance does not really mean that in vivo the drug is not acting. My third take-home message is, if there's failure of relief or clinical worsening, please refer to the cornea specialist or to a higher center. If the patient is post-traumatic or having a post-surgical condition, again, this could be an emergency. If you have to give the patient fortified and you do not have a means of compounding it, send it to the higher referral place. And if the patient is necessitating a globe-saving procedure like therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty and you have no facility to do it, please do so. Thank you so much. And this is my acknowledgement to my laboratory.
Thank you, Meena. That was a very exhaustive and a comprehensive talk on bacterial keratitis and resistance. I think we'll take up a few questions now which have come up. Dr. Ravi Matani wants to know, Rajesh, how to procure amniotic membrane in peripheral centers where it is not available. And also, I think we can take the second question from the Facebook, which says whether can you use wet amniotic membrane or dry amniotic membrane. Is okay if you use dry amniotic membrane, which is commercially available?
I think dry amniotic membrane can be used. That is one, which is if you don't have anything which is whatever is commercially available, that can be used. That is one. As far as procurement of amniotic membrane is concerned, what we do is that it should be done under sterile aseptic condition, And what we do normally in a multi-specialty hospital, you can get the amnion and chorion together and separate the chorion, and then the amniotic membrane has to be processed, and it is stored in the modified Eagle's medium, and all these things processing is done under aseptic condition, under laminar flow system. So this is how we procure the exact percentage of the Eagle's medium and all these things. I don't remember, but this is how we do at our center. We process it in the iBank and we keep it at -89°C. And once we have to use it, we take it out, thaw it, and then use it. But if it's not, one cannot process it, then commercially available amniotic membrane can be used.
This is just to acknowledge the fact that now Rajesh, of course, is professor of several years in RP Center. But when RP Center started its first amniotic membrane, it was done by Dr. Rajesh Sinha only, who helped to start the procurement of amniotic membrane at RP Center.
Yeah, it was long back, actually. That's why I'm forgetting the exact percentages and all those things. Yeah, but sure. This is how
not to say that Rajesh is less in experience, but to say that, you know, it was done so long while ago at RP Center. So I thought you would be the best person to answer this. Anybody else has had any experience with the dry amniotic membrane? Because we don't use too much of dry. Yes, Dr. Rishi, we don't use too much dry because for us, wet is available. But I'm sure in those places or those centers where wet amniotic membrane is not available, dry is available. We would like you to share your experience on dry amniotic membrane.
Dr. Rishi, are muted.
I did use it in a couple of cases and I was not excited. I thought the wet amniotic membrane is better, but it's probably better than not putting anything. So in the situation where the wet is not available and we don't normally have wet, we have to order it. It can sometimes take a day or two for it to come. And these are not situations where one can wait. So having a dry available to you, which can sit in a cupboard or in a refrigerator and is lying in the OT, is always a good thing to have as a standby. But if access to wet membrane is available, I would always prefer wet.
Nikhil, next question is for you. And it says that, are there any studies in vernal keratoconjunctivitis between cyclosporin and tacrolimus? And would you like to comment on when you would like to use which one?
So there are studies which have sort of started patients on cyclosporin, shifted on tacrolimus, and many of these studies basically show that they have comparable results. So if we assume that both the drugs work fairly similarly and equally well, then we have the choice of either compounding a drop versus a ready-made ointment which is available. So just like the earlier question, we have situations where it may be not possible to get the injection and prepare drops, which may not be very convenient. Patient may not be able to follow up to get these drops prepared. Tacrolimus is extremely useful in those situations because it's commercially available at the required concentration that we want. However, the convenience of using a drop is a little bit more than the tacrolimus, which is in the form of an ointment, which may cause some blurring of vision and may not also tends to cause a little bit more burning. So if you can reconstitute cyclosporin either from the injection or you can use the drops, which are also available, but we may have to order them. They may not be available in the regular chemist, then they might be probably a very good option as well. And there are some patients where I've had that patients were on cyclosporin, they were having still a little bit of residual inflammation, and I've added the tacrolimus ointment at bedtime as an add-on. So you can also combine the two agents. Overall, if you see, both the drugs work very well. So in situations where you have access problems, I think it's easier to use tacrolimus today. My talk is based on maybe 25 years I've been using cyclosporin, because at that period of time, there was no tacrolimus which was available commercially. And so I totally depended on using cyclosporin.
Then there's another question for, again, any one of us can answer that. Has anybody used cyclosporin stronger than 2%, I don't think I haven't used. Has anyone used stronger than 2% cyclosporine? Then role of oral, I have not.
I guess the reason why probably we have not used it, because what I remember from the project that we had done long back for gonal graft rejection, 2%, so I could read the literature. So in that, they had mentioned that the safety of 2% has been done. So the safety study has been done up to 2% only. Beyond that, it has not been done. And 2% cyclosporine given four times a day will have a concentration, blood concentration of less than 165 nanogram per ml, and that is much lower than the toxic level that that can cause any systemic toxicity. So perhaps that is the reason why we have not used it.
Also, it's Rajesh, it's extremely irritant at those higher concentrations.
Yeah.
So that is true. I think anything beyond 2% would probably not be within the tolerance levels of most people.
And maybe with systemic absorption, it can cause some systemic toxicity as well.
So this question is again for Meena and Dr. Lakshmipathy. And it says, although it's not related to bacterial keratitis, but Dr. Vasantha wants to know, how do you treat microsporidial keratitis?
If it is keratoconjunctivitis, people have only debrided and given any ointment. There are groups which have assumed that it is only self-limiting and just not debrided and continued only some fluoroquinolones. And there are antiprotozoal drugs like PHMB has been used. So these are the three methods of treating microsporidial keratoconjunctivitis. And some people believe it is self-limiting. I personally debride and give a fluoroquinolone for these patients and keep a close watch for 2 weeks, because sometimes there could be recurrences in between the areas that you have removed. There could be the new lesions. For microsporidial stromal keratitis, which is little rare than the keratoconjunctivitis, there is no antiprotozoal agent that is available for killing these agents. And you can only try some antiprotozoal agents like propamidine or PHMB, but they really don't work. And few people have even tried voriconazole. The predominant treatment of choice is therapeutic penetrating keratoplasty. And I wouldn't even advise deep anterior lamellar keratoplasty, because if the spores remain on the bed, there could be a recurrence even as late as 6 months.
So there is one more question to which I have no answer. And so I'm looking from all of you. What is the color coding for limbal ischemia? Dr. Rishi, would you remember?
Limbal ischemia.
I can't remember what.
We use color codings, but yes, you're right. Limbal ischemia, I don't think has a specific code.
Do we really have a color coding for limbal ischemia?
I'm not even sure it has a specific code.
I don't think there is a color coding for limbal ischemia.
I thought as much that, you know, there is no color coding for limbal
ischemia. I think we could only cover the conjunctiva as an epithelial defect, a green color. And we put yellow on the ischemic area. I think that's what we have done. We put yellow on the ischemic area.
Yeah, yellow would be, but yeah, but that also infiltrates.
Yellow is for infiltrate.
It looks like an abscess, because that surrounding that infiltrate bed, you have to write it. It's ischemia and not an infiltrate.
Yeah.
So I think with this, we come to the next talk. And the next talk is going to be a very difficult talk. Dry eye talk is always extremely difficult for any speaker to speak. And I now invite Dr. Rishi Mohan to give his talk on ocular surface homeostasis, to treat dry eye disease, restoration of the tear film homeostasis.
Can you see my slides?
Yes.
All right. So thank you so much, Namrata, and to have me on this panel and to invite me to speak. So I'm going to be talking about dry eye disease and how to restore the tear film homeostasis. And we do realize that we nowadays are talking more and more about the restoration of the ocular surface, because we have got a deeper understanding now of how dry eye proceeds and what the vicious circle of dry eye disease is. We're all very familiar with this circle. Over the years, this has now become a part and parcel of how we have learned our ocular surface. And we do know that there are so many factors, but there are two aspects to this, which are the core mechanisms, which is inflammation and hyperosmolarity, and how the tear film instability is impacted not only by intrinsic mechanisms, meibomian or lid conditions, but also a host of other extrinsic factors which one can see as they spin around in this circle. They all interact with each other and they tend to amplify the problem and create apoptosis. So when we talk about protecting against these mechanisms of dry eye disease, the goal of treatment is to reestablish homeostasis and integrity of the ocular system. And this is done by either preventing the patient from entering this vicious circle or promoting his exit from it. One may prevent entry into this circle by addressing certain factors such as systemic disease, contact lens use, and all those other factors that are there, like surgeries, lasers, infections, etc. And to promote the exit would involve addressing these central mechanisms, such as the instability, inflammation of the lacrimal functional unit, and the tear hyperosmolarity. So I'm going to largely talk about the restoration in this, but the effective management of dry eye disease would depend on the points of emphasis in the vicious cycle, where and when and how to intervene to understand the etiopathogenesis and to break it down into its causation and the levels of the disease severity, to differentiate again between what is largely aqueous deficiency and what is largely evaporative dry eye, and accommodate those overlaps, and then to direct the cause, direct the management at the cause. So we know that dry eye has a chronic immune-mediated inflammatory disease, and it's dependent largely on T cell activation. And this affects the entire ocular surface and includes the lacrimal glands in that process. So it's a physiological response to the invading pathogens, or an antigen in this case. The ocular inflammation due to infection or injury can also result in ocular inflammatory disease, and excessive inflammatory responses do damage even the healthy tissues and affect parts of the ocular system which become tender and inflamed. The triggering factors of inflammation are the ocular surface immune homeostasis, which is regulated by the CD4 regulatory T cells and which interact with anti-inflammatory factors. And the stress factors may all disturb the finely tuned homeostasis, including environmental challenges and the other factors that I've already enumerated. So the any increase in tear film osmolarity, which produces a hyperosmotic desiccating environment, leads to an increased mechanical shear stress, and innate inflammatory events lead to the chronic stimulation of corneal nerve endings. And this also generates a neurogenic response, which leads to the impairment of the ocular surface. So tissue destruction and neurosecreted by the inflammatory cytokines are the consequences of inflammation in dry eye disease. And this chronic neural damage leads to a reduction in the reflex tear secretion, a loss of the sensory drive through the lacrimal gland, and a decrease in corneal sensitivity. Altered tear levels of these neuromodulators also clinically correlate with the severity of the dry eye disease. So when there is influx of calcium into the cell, there is a reaction that happens inside, it binds to calcineurin. There is a nuclear factor which gets dephosphorylated, enters the cell nucleus, and then there is a transcription of genes which is involved in the immune response. So this cytokine activation then leads to glandular destruction. It leads to a production of adhesion molecules and retention of inflammatory cells. It leads to promotion of apoptosis, and the cell division and the neurosecretory block disrupts the natural tear film and produces a decrease in the quantity and quality of the tears. When one looks at the timelines of how this process happens, it's broadly divided into three phases. The immediate phase, where there is a stress kinase activation, and then follows for the next week by a phase of acute epithelial disease, which is largely driven by epithelial derived factors, cytokines, matrix metalloproteinases, and chemokines. And then by the end of the seventh or eighth day, there is now an influx of what we call the activated T cells. And these then produce the cell-mediated immune response and a chronic ocular surface damage. So over the years, techniques have been developed to diagnose inflammation, to identify and validate the surface inflammatory biomarkers, and further understand the mechanisms, and to also look at the clinical efficacy of these anti-inflammatory treatments. So when one talks about the MMP9, which is a proteolytic enzyme produced by these stressed ocular surface cells, it is secreted at the high levels by ocular surface epithelia in patients with dry eye disease. And whenever there's an increase in MMP9, there's a disruption of the corneal epithelial barrier function and corneal surface irregularity, which then perpetuates the tear film instability. So patient symptoms in dry eye and all of these, And these are often exacerbated by conditions that will increase the tear evaporation. And the and now, of course, with in COVID times, it's especially important because we are doing so much more computer use, prolonged reading and television viewing, that all these aspects are being exacerbated. So how to diagnose inflammation? Now, the initial patient exam, the inflammation may not be initially evident, and it can be overlooked as well. But the lack of response or a partial response to conventional therapeutic approaches may suggest that there is an inflammation. So a thorough medical history, note especially features like systemic conditions like rheumatoid, et cetera, the presence of all these patient symptoms, determination of the visual function and the examination of the eyelids and the lid margins, the examination of the face, the lid anatomy, the discharge, the hyperemia, especially presence of rosacea. This will almost invariably mean there is an inflammation of the ocular surface, and the order of the diagnostic tests that we run, from an OSDI to the examination of the face, the slit lamp exam, non-invasive breakup time and ocular surface staining, the Schirmer's test and the inflammatory marker testings is generally done towards the end. Now the MMP9 has a crucial role in wound healing and inflammation, and is instrumental in the pathogenesis of dry eye disease, and is shown to be consistently elevated in tears of patients with dry eye. It's a simple test called InflammaDry, and it will give us an absolute value of whether there is an adequate amount of MMP9 or not. That's the best way to actually diagnose inflammation, other than the clinical impressions that one might have looking at the various signs and symptoms. So to treat, there are many standard therapies that are there. So patient education, environmental and dietary modifications, the first line of defense always being artificial tears, which lubricate the ocular surface, produce some dilution effect, but they do not directly address inflammation. So patients with moderate to severe dryness should always be considered for anti-inflammatory therapies alongside. So these are the therapies that are available to us. They are topical corticosteroids, a host number of non-glucocorticoid glucocorticoid immunomodulators. Two of them have already been discussed by Nikhil, cyclosporin and tacrolimus. There are other NSAIDs, and now there is the LFA1 antagonists that are there. And then there are inflammatory modulations by systemic and topical antibiotics such as tetracycline and some of the macrolides like erythromycin. So corticosteroids are by far the most potent of these anti-inflammatories, and they are effective for short-term treatment, and they have been shown to have clinical value in these short-term pulsed therapies, and they act on various inflammatory responses and clinically improve the dry eye symptoms in many trials, but there are issues with their use, especially if it's long-term use, and if one has to use them, then the preference would be on softer or short-acting or superficially acting steroids like fluoromethylone and loteprednol. So the focus of the anti-inflammatory aspects is largely on this molecule, which is called cyclosporin. It has immunomodulatory and anti-inflammatory properties. It reduces many markers of inflammation, reduces the elevated osmolarity, has anti-apoptotic effects. It's reported to result in the recovery of reduced goblet cell density, but there are drawbacks as well, and which I will enunciate in the next few slides. So how does this work? So I had shown you this slide earlier of how calcium binds to calcineurin and causes the dephosphorylation of nuclear factor of activated T cells and produces the transcription of genes. So what the cyclosporin does is that it binds to cyclophilin and does not allow the calcineurin activation. So the T cells are not activated and cannot proliferate. So this is then in effect what we would call immunosuppression. If one looks at certain data or evidences for this, one can see here the baseline number of immune staining for activated T cells in a patient of dry eye disease. And this is what happens after 6 months. One can see a substantial reduction. One can see that there is a significant reduction in the number of cells which express these inflammatory markers such as CD11A and HLA-DR. And then there are clinical studies as well. The phase 3 studies showed significant reduction in corneal staining scores, changes in baseline values from baseline values in Schirmer's, in the vision blur, in the reduction of the amount of artificial tears being used, and an increase in the goblet cell density. There was efficacy also reported in the treatment of MGD, wherein we found that there is a reduction in the number of meibomian gland inclusions in patients who are on CSA compared to the placebo. And this may then expand the possibility of usage of cyclosporine in patients with evaporative dry eye as well. The dry eye symptom score was significantly reduced in patients after cataract surgery when cyclosporine was used in this study by Chung et al. And also after refractive surgery, patients who were treated with cyclosporine saw a decrease in the mean OSDI scores and also provided greater predictability of their refractive correction between 3 and 6 months after the surgery, rather than with just artificial tears. The efficacy of the use of cyclosporine in contact lens wearers showed some improvement in the OSDI scores, but there was no statistical difference between the groups. And there was also no statistical difference between the amount of rewetting drops being used in these patients. But if one sees the ancillary drug use in patients who are on cyclosporine, one can see that with pre-cyclosporine versus post-cyclosporine, there's a substantial reduction in the use of NSAIDs, in the use of antihistamines, in the use of steroids, and even in the use of lubricating agents as compared to what they were using before the start of cyclosporine. So there is a quite a diverse effect that is there on the ocular surface with the use of cyclosporine. And one can see which are the profiles of the patients who would be best benefiting from these. They would probably be in the middle of the range, which is really the majority of our patients. Those with occasional symptoms can well be controlled by artificial tears. Those with very severe or advanced disease would probably not respond to cyclosporine as well because they don't have much surface functionality of their lacrimal glands. So they would not be the ideal patients to use cyclosporine on, but most of our patients lie in the middle and they were the ones who are likely to be most benefited by cyclosporine. A couple of things which are important to remember about CSA is that the effect is not instant. And if one looks at this chart, one sees that the spy diagram that only 32% started to show some difference in symptoms by the end of the first week, but that expanded to around 73% by the end of the third week and almost 90% by the end of the fifth week. So it does take time for this impact to come. One starts to see, and we all know now that topical steroids, the use of topical steroids to initiate the process of anti-inflammatory control is very useful. And here the results demonstrated that the use of steroids improved the patient tolerance and acceptance of chronic cyclosporine therapy. And so it's probably a good thing to start patients with moderate dry eye on low intensity steroid for 2 or 3 weeks till the cyclosporine starts to take effect. So it's also important to do good patient counseling. And here one can see that the patient education is essential for doing these, for having successful treatments. Patients must be informed of the common adverse events and also be told that they will lessen over time. And this helps to allow them to stay true and be compliant with the requirements of using this drop. And then good clinical improvements can be achieved in the vast majority. Tacrolimus, again, it has already been discussed, but is very similar to cyclosporine and is largely to be used in those who are intolerant to topical cyclosporine for some reason or where the response to topical cyclosporine is poor. Omega-3 fatty acids for anti-inflammatory use had really come with a big bang and they were used very widely. Then with the publication of the DREAM study, they went a little bit into the background. I do still feel that they have a role, especially in the evaporative dry eye, because they have a wider effect on the way they work with the cytokines and how they are of use in a deficient or an unstable lipid layer. Lifitegrast, which is still not available in India, is a small molecule antagonist to LFA1, and it blocks the interaction of this ligand, which leads to a immunosuppression. And the 5% solution is used as a competitive antagonist to block the binding between LFA1 and ICAM1. And this reduces the adhesion and inhibits the secretion of inflammatory cytokines, and that's how it produces its effect. So in summary, inflammation is one of the four key mechanisms of dry eye disease. The stimulation of inflammatory mediators results in a positive feedback, and the examination of the patient's face, slit lamp exam, etc., helps in the diagnosis of this inflammation. And there's a wealth of therapies that is there, and it is effective at reducing the signs and symptoms of dry eye disease. This is the summary of anti-inflammatory therapies that currently exist, from cyclosporins, steroids, the tetracyclines, O3FAs, cytokine inhibitors, TNF-alpha inhibitors, artificial tears and secretagogues. But the corticosteroids, tetracyclines and the macrolides have some side effects associated with this local use. And to address inflammation, cyclosporin should remain our number one product. When we talk about osmolarity, we do realize that these patients who have a normal osmolarity are the ones who don't normally fit into the dry eye group. But whenever the osmolarity goes up beyond 316 is when we start to call them as hyperosmolar. And spikes in the tear film osmolarity of between 8 and 900 are thought to occur over the central cornea, but there is no possibility of being able to collect a sample there. And so these are the things that we normally use. So osmolarity is extremely important. And this is what it is in an isotonic state. You have a well-hydrated corneal epithelium with a well-hydrated tear film on top. But when this tear film evaporates and becomes more concentrated, it sucks out the water by osmosis from the epithelial tear cells, the epithelial cells, which shrink. And as they shrink and get dehydrated, there is a regulatory volume compensation that starts to happen. And the tear cell, the epithelial cell starts to break in salts to produce what it calls a regulatory volume adjustment. And this restoration of cell volume is accompanied by the ingress of all these active metabolites, such as sodium and potassium and magnesium and chlorides and bicarbonates. And these then decrease the cell function, and they cause stress activation and cell damage and death. So this again starts to happen fairly rapidly and then starts to create the cell mediated inflammation as well. But how can this be helped? This can be helped. So if we look at the same animation that I showed you earlier, one can, or the dehydrated cell can have the option of having a regulatory volume increase by doing what it calls a compatible solute intake. Compatible solutes are essentially osmoprotectants, which can be taken up by the cells, and they bring in water molecules with it to restore the cell volume and stabilize the protein function. So cells protect themselves by either synthesizing or importing solutes. And there are numerous tissues in the body which experience hypertonicity. And all of these tissues have the capacity to either synthesize or import compatible solutes, which are essentially small non-ionic organic compounds that build intracellular osmotic strength without damaging proteins. And osmoprotection is when the cell function is maintained without damage under hypertonic conditions. So these are a list of the osmoprotectants or compatible solutes that are available in nature. They're methylamine, they're polyols, they're amino acids, small carbohydrates, urea. And these compatible solutes are all available in many of the products that are now commercially available. And these are the ones that are going to be discussed here. So laboratory studies have shown that these compatible solutes do make a difference. And one sees the ratio of these MAP kinases, which in hypertonic media become the ratio of phosphorylation doubles. Once they are given L-carnitine and erythritol in the medium, they come back to normal. And both these graphs show that. One sees a corneal dehydration model and compares it with a non-regulated tear preparation. One can see that the dehydration with no treatment is much worse than the dehydration with an osmotically regulated tear preparation compared to one that is not osmotically regulated. Similarly, osmoprotectants suppress the production and activity of MNPs induced by the hyperosmolarity in human corneal epithelial cells. And if one sees the expression of these enzymes in various hyperosmolar situations, in the presence of L-carnitine and erythritol, even at 450 milliosmoles, there wasn't much expression of these enzymes, which suggests that there is a suppressive effect of L-carnitine and erythritol on MMP production. In the clinical evidence too, patients who are on these regulated preparations tend to do much better with lower OSDI scores and lower number of mean drops being used. If one sees the difference with switchover trials, you find that between 75 and 85% of patients improve comfort as well as improve clinical signs and an improve in a tear breakup time. So there's an expanding pool of data that suggests that there is a role of osteoprotectants in patients with DAD. And this osteoprotective effect depends on how much of the osteoprotectant the cell can take up and for how long it can be retained. So osteoprotectants are of various sizes, like glycerol and erythritol, which are small polyols and can go in and out of the cell very quickly. In contrast, L-carnitine is a slightly larger molecule and will then take longer to go in and will stay in much longer as well. So a combination of osteoprotectants with different kinetics may actually work better to increase the overall production in dry eye. And several of these amino acids and related compounds may function as long-acting intracellular compatible solutes and protein stabilizers as well. So the conventional artificial tears only have an impact on the surface. They only increase tear retention time and decrease evaporation, but they do not have any other impact on the actual cell metabolism or the its morphology. So if one looks at the hypotonic solutions with an attempt to restore tear osmolarity, they only provide a transient control of tear osmolarity because within a minute or two of using a hypoosmotic agent, the osmolarity goes into the hyperosmolar phase. So this is not really a very effective tool in terms of using hypotonic lotions. So to summarize, dry eye produces significant ocular surface damage, which is mediated by hyperosmolarity of the tear film. And this is a key mechanism in the evolution of the dry eye, and the cells that can utilize compatible solutes can then use that as a regulatory mechanism to maintain osmotic balance. They can help regulate the osmolar balance and stress, restore the tear film osmolarity, and thereby improve the health of the homeostasis of the eye. So to protect against the mechanisms of dry eye disease, again, reestablishment of homeostasis integrity is important. Aim to prevent the patient from entering the vicious circle by preventing the or addressing the additional factors and promote his exit from the vicious circle as well. So this is the what I would suggest is we use lid hygiene, osmoprotection and tear substitutes, oral tetracyclines and other antibiotics, steroids, cyclosporine and omega-3 fatty acids, other than the other avoidance and environmental strategies. So what Namrata had written was to have two slides which would tell us about what to do, and specific to my talk, I created these. So the diagnosis of inflammation in our clinical environments is based largely on clinical signs such as hyperemia, ocular surface staining. If we have an access to inflammatory marker assessment, yes, then the MMP9 can be picked up. And the observation of non-improvement with conventional treatments would suggest that there is probably an inflammatory mechanism at play. The diagnosis of hyperosmolarity is unfortunately only assumed unless one has access to a tear lab or a hyperosmolarity measurement device, and the treatments are directed towards the cause and to restore the homeostasis. When you address this, the anti-inflammatory agents, the use of osmoprotection, again with compatible solutes in the eye drops, and there too, those with a balanced mix of compatible solutes rather than just compatible solutes, and the avoidance of preservatives. And consider a referral if there is moderate to severe dry eye disease, if for some reason there is non-availability of diagnostics or the non-availability of certain therapeutic modalities such as preservative-free medication or many of these other things that we have, or a non-response to conventional protocols that we normally would employ in treating our patients. So thank you so much for your kind attention, and be positive and stay negative.
Thank you, Rishi. I think that was a very comprehensive talk on dry eye. Now we'll just come to questions which are there. And one question is, Dr. Rajesh, whether sodium ascorbate and sodium citrate is available commercially, and whether you have to, you know, prepare it. I think this is a question we get every time. And I'm not sure if Aurolab is already making, you know, one of the products commercially and giving it. Okay. So any thoughts on it?
I'm not aware whether it's available commercially, but yes, we do prepare 10% sodium citrate and sodium ascorbate in our pharmacy, and that's how we provide it to the patients.
Sodium ascorbate, Rajesh, is available commercially. It comes as an injectable solution, and it comes in 10% strength.
Okay.
So one can take it directly and use it topically.
Okay. Okay.
And there's one more question for you. How do you know the pH in case of chemical injury? How do you monitor the pH?
It's by a pH paper. The pH paper is available freely in the market. And once you do a complete wash, you wait for 5 minutes so that the pH stabilizes, and then you check the pH. This is what is very important.
Another for you, Nikhil, is what is the onset of topical cyclosporin, onset of action?
Yeah, so normally we expect it is not as quickly acting as a topical steroid would act. So the action is slow to begin with, but once it comes on, if you withdraw the cyclosporin, it might take 2 weeks or 4 weeks for the effect to slowly wear off. So initially, in very severe cases, you can give a steroid and the cyclosporin can be continued longer and the steroid can be tapered and stopped. So you'll have immediate control of inflammation with the steroid, and for the long-term use, the cyclosporin, you know, can go on. So the action comes a little slow as compared to steroid. So you can use a combination initially if there is severe inflammation, and then continue the cyclosporin.
This is related to adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis, and I want everybody's opinion on it. Suppose those numeral opacities are recurrent. What is your method? How do you deal it with Dr. Reddy? Can you start? You know, suppose they are recurrent more than 2 times. They have appeared. The patient has come to you for the 3rd time. So what would be your protocol? I mean, do you combine cyclosporin and tacrolimus, or you just give one of them and combine it with steroids? And what do you have more faith on, tacrolimus or cyclosporin?
Tacrolimus. Cyclosporin is a little milder in action. Tacrolimus, generally we go for a serious disease, we go for 0.1%. If it is mild, we go for 0.03%. 0.1% twice a day, almost most of the times within a month, they will have very good relief. But only thing is how long. Sometimes we continued even for 6 months to 1 year once a day, tacrolimus in these cases. That's what I have a small question for you exactly.
Okay.
Put in your last slide, the steroids, cyclosporin and tacrolimus for numular keratitis, you know. In fact, our sequence is a little different. We go steroids in the last. We just first jump to cyclosporins and tacrolimus for numular keratitis. Then in the end, if the patient is very intolerant, then we add on steroids for a short time.
Okay, Nikhil, how would you do it? I mean, I always tend to put steroids first and then put I have more faith on cyclosporin, maybe because we've not used too much of tacrolimus. Only in very resistant cases, the last resort, you move to tacrolimus. But we tend to give topical steroids and cyclosporin, and then withdraw the topical steroid as the cyclosporin, like you said, takes over in 6 weeks' time, and then see how it goes. And of course, lubricants, I mean, have to continue because they will remain for the entire for which you're giving the treatment. So what is your take on that?
So basically, you know, what happens sometimes in the referral practice is that we get patients who already use steroids for a few months, they've gone to multiple practitioners. So in that type of a situation, it's easier for me to counsel them. And I normally try to shift them to cyclosporin or tacrolimus and try to withdraw the steroid. Of course, counseling them that there will be some rebounds of the opacities and they will have some in the best quality of vision, but they need to sort of tide over the crisis, and usually things will improve in 6 months or a year's time. And that is easier for me. But when you have patients who are the first time coming directly to the clinic, it's a bitter pill to swallow if you tell them that you have to live with this for a year. And that is where very often we tend to lose the patient and the patient goes elsewhere. So I think we need to do adequate counseling to try and explain them. And there are a significant set of patients who may have just unilateral, dense central opacities, or they may have infiltrates which are manageable with the quality of vision and the work they are doing. So in these situations, I think I try to avoid giving either steroids or cyclosporine, only lubricants. And only when the situation is very desperate, then I would discuss with the patient. And preferably, I would first try to use cyclosporine or tacrolimus. And then if the patient is really inconvenienced, then use short courses of topical mild surface steroids. But it's always that whenever you use any suppressant medication, it prolongs the course of the disease and makes it longer. And then the withdrawal has to be done extremely slowly. So I think basically what's more important is to discuss all these options with the patient and then, take the best. Because sometimes we treat the eye directly without looking at the visual requirements. So maybe the patient is able to manage with the vision, then maybe it's best to avoid them. So we need to talk and discuss and then take a call as what is best management.
Dr. Meena, you would...
had this discussion at the Madras Ophthalmological Forum once, and what I gained from that talk was intense lubricant seems to really help in these patients rather than giving them any other medications because it is self-limiting. So substituting by giving them lubricants has a placebo effect and also gives the optical clarity for these patients. And of course, even for the first two times, I have given steroids, and maybe very few, 1 in 10 patients really need cyclosporine. But other than that, most of them tend to resolve.
Rishi, yes.
I've just heard all this. I just have my own algorithm of how I treat these patients because they've invariably come as a, they're not naive to me. They've usually been treated elsewhere and they've come. So first is to look at history of what they've been using in the past. And if there is a recurrence that keeps coming up, then one has to be careful in re-prescribing steroids. Then I look at the clinical picture and I decide whether these are central epithelial, subepithelial infiltrates. Then my treatment is a little more aggressive compared to those which are in the periphery. And then I stain them. And in staining, I look at three things. Number one, is there an alteration on the corneal surface? So you may have subepithelial infiltrates which are not disrupting the surface at all. That means there is no elevation. If there is no elevation, then the dry patch appears if there is an elevated area, and that suggests that there is a little bit of epithelial edema. If in the middle of that or on the surround of that, there is a staining as well, it means that now there is a breakdown of the surface epithelium as well. So these are, I look at it very differently. I think that the level of inflammation in all these conditions is different, and that then allows me to cater to or to sort of decide whether to use a steroid or just a cyclosporine or tacrolimus, or as Dr. Meena said, lubricants sometimes just do the job. You don't need to give them any anti-inflammatory at all. Just give them on intensive lubrication and see the response.
I guess, what I want to say is that, and what Dr. Namta also presented in her presentation, that steroid, there is a definite indication for steroid. Otherwise, we don't give steroid in all the cases of adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis. So if there is a central, nummular subepithelial haze causing reduction in visual acuity.
Mm-hmm.
So that is the indication. So if that is there, then I use a topical steroid and I always combine it with cyclosporine, because it is a known fact that whenever you use steroid, the risk of recurrence is high in these cases. So if it's a peripheral one, don't use steroid, intensive lubrication, and that is it will clear up and it is self-limiting and it will go off. But if it's central and it is causing reduction in visual acuity, then we have to use steroid or any immunomodulator. But I know what I do is I use steroid along with topical cyclosporine, and gradually I taper off steroid. Although there is no study indicating that cyclosporine prevents a recurrence or anything, but since it's an immunomodulator which can be used on a long-term basis, which can also improve the ocular surface, so that is why I continue using cyclosporine once this haze clears up and I taper off the steroid and use cyclosporine on a long term. Yeah,
Ajish, what would be your experience with chloroquine in these patients?
Chloroquine, I haven't used chloroquine in adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis, so I cannot say that. But then Chloroquine has also been used as immunomodulator or reducing inflammation of ocular surface. And there are a couple of studies which have shown comparable results with cyclosporin. So based on that study, one can say, but I don't have a personal experience because I haven't used chloroquine in adenoviral keratoconjunctivitis.
So I think this question is for Dr. Nikhil. Is oral antihistamine effective in vernal keratoconjunctivitis?
Yes, so as I said, basically, in general, when you're looking at a BKC patient, any antihistaminic is a supportive role. It's not going to treat the immune-mediated inflammation to that extent. But to reduce itching and to reduce maybe the symptomatically some congestion, you can use antihistaminic. Normally, we prefer to use topical agents which are dual acting. However, as I said, when we have children who have severe rhinitis, they have systemic allergy as well, then maybe giving a systemic agent might be more worthwhile. Also to remember that, you know, in the daytime, they may cause sedation. So you may have to give some of these agents at bedtime. But otherwise, basically, they have limited role as far as VKC is concerned. One would always prefer topical unless, there is no option.
Okay, so I think we've answered almost most of the questions which had come. And we would like to welcome Dr. Mahipal Sachdev, who is the President of All India Ophthalmological Society. And even before we begin this webinar, there were questions on, you know, collagen cross-linking in keratoconus. And I would request Sir to say a few words before he gives his talk on collagen cross-linking in thin corneas.
Thank you very much, Dr. Namrata, and good evening, everyone. Rishi, Rajesh, Dr. Reddy, Nikhil, sorry for being held up with clinical work. I think pleasure being here, and I obviously cornea is an important topic that needs to be covered. And I think I've missed out on maybe some good talks. So I think without much ado, can I just start with my talk?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Okay. Sure. Thank you. Is everything visible?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, it's there.
Okay, fine. I'll be talking about corneal cross-linking in thin corneas. So essentially, as you all know that today, nobody waits for a keratoconus patient to be progressing and going on for keratoplasties, etc., or do a rehabilitation with contact lens only. Corneal cross-linking has become the treatment of choice, and it's a gold standard practiced all over the world. Now, as you all know that corneal cross-linking is the only treatment modality that is available till date, which halts the progression of keratoconus and is a well-established modality. And it has also got FDA approval as things stand, and it is being world over, it is being practiced the world over. Now, what is important is that the standard Dresden protocol, what it says is that if you have to have the endothelium being safe, there needs to be, after the epi is off, a 400 microns that is required before you apply the corneal cross-linking. And this is above the damage threshold of the endothelium. So if you have 400 microns, the threshold from 0.18 goes to 0.3. So that is something very, very important that has been taken as I would say till a couple of years ago as the Lakshman Rekha, which is there. But unfortunately, majority of the patients of keratoconus, specifically the ones who started keratoconus in the younger age, they come with thinner corneas. And in the Indian circumstances, as also in the Middle East, etc., the progression is found to be pretty fast. And the referral to centers where there is cross-linking is occurring at a later stage. I think even today, the optometrist or the optical shop still want to not lose the patient and continue to give contact lens rehabilitation to these patients and do not refer. Now, once you have these corneas, which come to you in keratoconic patients where the corneal thickness is below 400 microns, there is the need to do corneal cross-linking in these cases, at least to try and retrieve the situation. So what does one do in such cases? Now, these are various treatment modalities which have been used over time, and I'll discuss them. This is the treatment modality of using hypotonic. Then you have transepithelial. So you have the iontophoresis, contact lens assisted, and lenticule-assisted are the various modalities that have been described. Now, the first modality that was proposed way back in 2007 was by Hafizi et al. And they described the installation of hypotonic riboflavin. So you all know we started with dextran, then went on to the HPMC, and then these are for the thin corneas where you have hypotonic riboflavin. So what you are doing is that because it is a hypotonic riboflavin, you are constantly putting drops. So there is an increase in the intraoperative time. This is, you have to wait till such time that the cornea swells up. So actually you are inducing a swelling up of the cornea by using hypotonic riboflavin. Now the disadvantage of this is that the riboflavin that is going is of a relatively lower concentration of the collagen, and the stroma gets hydrated. Because the stroma gets hydrated, the collagen fibers become farther apart, and therefore the effect of cross-linking in the hypoosmolar riboflavin is less. Now, the next thing that came was that because what we said was that the endothelium needs to be 400 microns or more away from the focusing of the ultraviolet light. So therefore, the idea came that if we do not remove the epithelium, that means that the 60 microns to 65 microns that we have of the thickness of the epithelium, that is saved, and therefore the you are working on a thicker cornea as compared to an epi-off cornea. So this was called as a trans-epithelial cross-linking, in which there was no epithelial debridement that was done. And there were attempts to loosen the attachments of the epithelium by applying proprocaine eye drops every 5 minutes for 15 minutes, or by using BAC or by using EDTA, etc., by which you could actually pre-soak the cornea, and by loosening the epithelial barriers, you would be able to have concentration. But again, the problem here was that the concentration of the riboflavin into the cornea was much lower, and therefore the transepithelial cross linking did not give as good results. Now, the next thing that came was that if we are able to induce a permeation of the riboflavin by using electrical current, so that is called as iontophoresis, which is a non-invasive technique in which a small electric current is applied to enhance an ionized drug's penetration through the intact epithelium. So this is what was thought to be good, and the major advantage that was touted was that it would spare the epithelium and would avoid the discomfort, could make it therefore an office procedure, and the infection, etc., would be avoided because you are not going to have the epi-off. But again, the problem here is that even though the riboflavin is negatively charged structure and has low molecular weight that is being used, the iontophoresis did not give excellent results. The procedure of iontophoresis is shown here, where an annular suction ring is applied. From here, you have an electric current that is applied, and 0.1% riboflavin, no dextran or sodium chloride, and addition of two enhancers, that is EDTA and trometol, were put onto the riboflavin. And a constant current generator was given. And after this, because it was able to penetrate through the intact epithelium, you gave an irradiation of 10 milliwatts for 9 minutes. So that is what was done. Now, the initial study that was given by Vinsigura et al., which was of 20 eyes, 12-month follow-up, there was a halting of the progression of the keratoconus and a significant improvement in the corrected distance vision acuity. Now, what was again looked at by other people was that the transepithelium cross-linking, the efficacy was controversial, as the penetration of riboflavin was again found to be deficient. So whether it was an epi-on procedure with paracaine or whether it was a transepithelial with the iontophoresis, the penetration of riboflavin was less. And the other problem that is there is, which was highlighted subsequently, that when the epithelium is on, the epithelium takes away the oxygen availability. And as you all know, that when you have to cross-link a cornea, the oxygen should be available. So if the epithelium has been scraped off, then the stroma does not take up that much of oxygen as much as the oxygen which is taken by the epithelium. So that was another reason why the effect was not found to be good in the transepithelium. And these are 23% of keratoconus cases in the transepithelial group continued to progress. This was Soters et al. Who said, versus the epi-off. So epi of you had a much higher response that was there as compared to whether it is transepithelial with iontophoresis or transepithelial otherwise. Now the next thing that came to increase the thickness of the cornea so that you have the endothelium that is away was described by Susan Jacob et al. From the Agarwal Eye Hospitals, and they used a soft contact lens. So you are using a soft contact lens to artificially increase the distance between the top of the cornea and the endothelium. But the problem was that the riboflavin could be trapped in the precorneal space. The absorption properties of a soft contact lens are obviously different from a stroma. And there is an inability to customize the thickness of the cross contact lens. So it's a standard 100 micron thickness of the contact lens, which is there. And there is a buckling of the contact lens due to the procedure. So these are the disadvantages of the contact lens induced or contact lens assisted cross-linking. Now we in our group have described a technique called as tailored stromal expansion by using a SMILE lenticule. So this is something that we have described, which has been published in the Journal of Cataract and Refractive Surgery in the year 2015. Now, what we do is that depending upon the thickness of the cornea of the keratoconic patient, that means supposing a keratoconic patient, epi of has 340 microns of corneal thickness. So you want it to be increased by 60 microns. So if you are having a patient of SMILE, which is say four diopters of refractive error, then the lenticule that you will be taking out, the central part of the lenticule that you take out in the SMILE would be approximately 60 microns. And you will place this lenticule onto the keratoconic cornea, and the thickest portion of the lenticule will be over the thinnest portion of the keratoconic cornea. So this is essentially the procedure that you have, where you remove the epithelium. So it is an epi-off procedure. You have a patient of SMILE. You can post these patients on the same day, or you can have a SMILE lenticule preserved also. You can preserve it in MK medium or whatever you want. And you have taken out this lenticule and you are placing it on top of the recipient. So obviously you will have to do the dry rot test in these patients and see that the patient is not transmitting any disease. So this is what you do. So you soak the lenticule, and you can see as also the endothelium, and you can see that we had a good penetration. After the cross-linking has been done, the lenticule, which sticks very well, is then removed. And then you after the cross-linking, you normally place the contact lens as is there. Now, we have shown excellent results in these cases. These were the results that were published, but we have since a long follow-up. And the first series that we did, the lowest corneal thickness that we had, epi of, was 326, 324 actually, and we got good results. There was no loss of the endothelium, and the demarcation lines that came were good. There was the stromal haze that you normally get after the cross-linking, which absorbed. And you can see that this is the contact, this is the cross-linking, the demarcation line that you can see that comes out pretty well in these cases. So the advantages of our technique are that this is a physiological increase in the thickness of the cornea. You are using stroma only to increase the stromal thickness. You can tailor make the expansion. So supposing I have a 10 diopter SMILE patient, so I will be having about 130 microns. So you can actually tailor make the stromal expansion, and you can augment it over the area where you want. There is a very firm adherence to the underlying cornea of the stroma. So therefore, there is no question of any buckling. There is no question of pooling of any riboflavin, etc. And you get a great outcome. Now, we have subsequently a five-year follow-up. We have published of three cases of intracorneal ring segment implantation along with lenticule-assisted stromal augmentation for cross-linking in thin corneas in the American Journal of Ophthalmology. So this has been published recently as a case report in this year only. And what you have seen here is that these are the three cases, and they had extremely thin corneas. And you can see that preoperatively, the keratometry is from 73.5, because we are using an intracorneal ring segment and a lenticule-assisted cross-linking. This has gone down to 65.7 from 55.4. It is 49. From 60.6, it has gone to 49.5. And you can see that the logmar best corrected visual acuity has improved significantly in all three cases. So it is a good technique, even if you are doing it in advance. So we have advanced keratoconus. We are doing the intact, but obviously the thickness in the paracentral region has to be sufficient for us to work with the intracorneal ring segments that is there. So this is a picture of the Visumax laser by which we do the intact. We are making the channels and we are putting in the intact ring, and then we go ahead, put the lenticule. As you can see here, this is the lenticule. After putting the riboflavin, you continue to put riboflavin, and then you do the cross-linking. Now, to say as to what were the things that were being done, so there are three parts to it. One is you alter the stromal thickness. The second part is that you alter the riboflavin. And the third part, which was not worked upon till very recently, is that can you change the amount of UV radiation that is being given to the cornea in thin corneas? So when we are looking at stromal thickness, transepithelial cross-linking was done, contact lens assisted cross-linking was the second, and our technique of lenticular assisted cross-linking was the third. The hypotonic cross-linking, hypotonic CXL was the use of riboflavin, which is hypotonic, to increase again the thickness of the cornea. But this new concept, which is gained ground, which is easily available with the Avedro machine, is what is known as an adapted fluence. So what they are saying now is that the total quantity of the fluence that you are giving onto the cornea is reduced. So this is the third part which is now being played out, which is the intensity of the UV light that is being given. So you are not working on the thickness of the cornea, you are not working on the riboflavin concentration, but you are working on the quantum of light that is being given onto the cornea in thin corneas. And this was reported by Hafizi et al, that biomechanical stiffening in porcine eyes, he showed in laboratory animal experiments, that slow, low irradiance corneal cross-linking was there versus the standard Dresden. So if you are reducing the quantum in thin corneas, it is going to work. And this is, his nomograms are still being worked upon, which will be available. If you have a 400 micron, this is 300, this is 250. So what he is saying, instead of the standard 5.4 joules per centimeter square, he has used only 3 and 9 milliwatts. That is what he is using for the fluence. But he will reduce the total energy from 5.4 to a lower amount. So this exact amount is going to be out in the nomograms as to what it is. And this is another prospective monocenter interventional study, 62 eyes, where it has been shown that in thin corneas, here you can see that the demarcation line is coming here, where the quantum of light that is there has been reduced. Now, Cosimo et al. Has also shown that pachymetry-based accelerated cross-linking, so instead of using the 3 and 9, they have used the accelerated cross-linking, and they have formed what is known as the M nomogram for standardized treatment of all thicknesses of progressive ectatic corneas. That means that depending upon the thickness, even if it is 200, 250, 200, etc. So this is the protocol they have made. And they have also used pulsed energy instead of a continuous in various places. And that is what they have shown, that by adapting the amount of fluence that you are giving on the cornea, you can work in thin cornea. So to sum up, what I will say is that no longer today, 400 microns is the threshold for cross-linking. There are several innovative techniques that have allowed us to stabilize corneas. The cones of keratoconic corneas, which are less than 400 microns also. And as discussed, hypoosmolar riboflavin, contact lens assisted cross-linking, iontophoresis assisted cross-linking, epion cross-linking have shown some success. But the tailored stromal expansion is the most physiological, and our studies have shown that there is a significant reduction in the progress of the cone, and it works as good as a normal cross-linking would in thin corneas. And finally, I think what may come around, which can be easily used by everybody, would be adapted fluence in various machines that is going to be adapted. And once the nomograms are standardized, this is going to be the way forward. Thank you very much for your kind attention.
Thank you so much. I think that's a huge quantum of work which has been done on collagen cross-linking, sir. And in thin corneas, I think so many new innovations are coming up. I think we'll take the questions on keratoconus after we complete the last talk. And the last talk will be given by Dr. J.K. Reddy, and he's going to be talking about customization on in cases of customized cross-linking in cases of keratoconus.
Thank you for the opportunity, and this talk made it very easy, and I can skip a lot of slides because Dr. Maipal has covered very extensively, very nicely about the cross-linking and many of this. Coming to the customizing, why should customize on this part? And the cross-linking is not anything new. This chemical cross-linking is there for a long time, where you use a chemical to establish a cross-link, which is commonly used in our footwear, leather bags, or purses, wallets, and everywhere it is used. What used in the cornea is glutaride is the commonest agent used in cross-linking. In biology, in human biology, we use the cardiac walls. Cardiac walls are cross-linked with the glutaride head, but they extract out the excess one, which is highly toxic. But in cornea, we use a physical cross-linking. No chemical is used. The riboflavin, which is used, works as an activator. That is not that will not stay permanently in the cornea. It comes out. It is washed up over a period of time. And what bonds, covalent bonds, they are formed in cornea is a physical bonds, not a chemical bonds. So this idea is picked up from the dentistry by Dr. Thiesiller. In dentistry, they shifted a long time from UV light. They use a photo initiator, and they use a UV light to make the cross-linking of epoxies, which they fitted into the cavities. But they shifted from UV light to blue light, but still in ophthalmology, still we stick on to the UV light because that is best absorbed by the riboflavin. And these three guys, they changed the world of keratoconus treatment. And unfortunately, the Grieger is no more seen. Valensack is not seen most of the times. We see Sporel, and mostly we see Thiesiller. Thiesiller is clinical work, and Sporel worked on the laboratory-wise, calculating all the dosage necessary. And the lab safety was done by the Grieger Valensack. He is Sporel designed the energy on what based on the physics and biology. He has designed the 5.4 joules for 8 millimeter diameter with riboflavin is 0.1% is optimum thing that is necessary for the cornea, and safe and optimum thing that is necessary for cornea of 500 microns thickness. So that's important. This is designed for the volume of the corneal tissue, not for the square surface area. Though energy is calculated for square area, the total energy is calculated for the volume of the area, taking 500 microns is the corneal average thickness. So he developed an energy plot also at the same time, long time back, some 15, 20 years back, for each corneal tissue, how much is the energy necessary. But unfortunately, this one is nobody follows. The 5.4 went as a standard into our minds and in the books. So we are traditionally following all or none phenomena, like 5.4 joules became a standard in our minds. But actually, Sporel has given a graph where, for example, if you are using 3 milliwatts or 9 milliwatts, what is the energy necessary for each corneal thickness? He's developed it almost 10 to 15 years back and is given according to his calculations, physical calculations. He's a scientist. He's not an ophthalmologist. So coming back to my talk, why we should customize at all for normal patient. For example, this patient, look at this patient. And he had a small keratoconus, definitive. We did a cross-linking. Patient is fine. Is unaided with beautiful vision. After 1 year, after 4 years, the area became flat. You gain to 38K now, 36. So this patient, if you look statistically, another patient, 37, and this is what happened over a period of time. Starting with 2007, 2015, 2016, over a period of 10 years, his K reading dropped from 44 to 36. So if you look statistically, it's a wonderful result. 10 diopters flattening, it comes in the graph, is the most significant and beautiful results. But look at the patient, this is a horrible. A patient from 6966 dropped down to 5/60 and he lost vision. This is why we need to customize cross-linking. This is another one, a central cone. If you cross-link 8 millimeters, yeah, it doesn't make any sense. For example, this patient with a cross-linking, this is the one after 1 year, patient improved unaided 6-9 vision, very nice flattened area in the center. This is after some time, this is after a few years, and this is one more year, three more years. This is the patient immediate post-op, and this is demarcation lines. So this patient now has got only around 660 vision. So it's totally dependent on contact lens. And coming back to the cones, you have a cone which is quite big, and you have a cone much bigger, and you have a cone which is much inferior, and you have a cone totally inferior. There's no pupil area involved at all, and much flattening in the superior. And there is a globus cone, and there is inferior cone with a little bit superior involvement, and there's a totally inferior cone and involving only the area, and there is a superior cone, and there is a very small central cone. Applying the same technique of 8 millimeters and 5.4 joules for each and every case, irrespective of except for the thickness, it doesn't make for me any sense in my clinical practice. So as Dr. Maipal has explained already, there are two systems of customization. One is the Avedra system, where they change the fluence. They give the highest fluence for the steepest cornea, 48K, 7.2 joules, and they reduce for periphery. The peripheral cornea, they reduce the fluence, thinking that the strongest energy is necessary for the weakest cornea, where there is the steepest cornea. And there is second system. I came this day actually for system, but I'm going for in this way. The customizing for each patient using the standard equipment which we are having, because Avedro, the pixel and the sister pixel 2 is very expensive. The total energy is variable. We can always change depending upon the thickness and size we have to change, location we can change, and we can add on PTK or PRK. What you can customize cross-linking, it all depends upon medicine beliefs and interpretation of available literature, clinical observations, and what you assume is correct, and hypothesis, and most importantly, what you like to do. That is what, why there is so many variations in the practice. There is always two sides for a coin. So keratoconus, what I believe is a local weakness, which progresses to become global. But there is a another thought, opposite thought, keratoconus is a global disease, starts one local elevation and progresses. So these are two opinions in everything, many opinions, two important. So the deepest cornea, I believe, is the weakest area. It can be anywhere irrespective of thinnest location. But there is opposite view. Other people argue thinnest location is the weakest point. Elevation is a consequence of biomechanical effect. I believe that strengthening the weakest and steepest area strengthens the cornea and prevents further progression. But there are my, I argue, there are people who argue with me, keratoconus is a progressive global disease. So wide area of standard treatment is necessary to arrest the disease over a period of time and prevent further progression. A stitching time saves 9. This is the one. So I believe that you weakened area, you strengthen, that's good enough. There is always opposite argument. A cloth that is bad, even if you stitch one place, it can break in another place, and you may need some more stitches in some other area. I believe that visual acuity is paramount importance in treatment and critical parameter for success of treatment. And there is opposite argument. Shape is the most important factor, and flattening is the most important denominator of the effect of cross-linking. And K-max is the important critical parameter for assessing the success of the treatment. So coming what we can stand customize in our standard cross-linking, the energy can be varied from 3.5 to 5.4 joules in a standard machine. But in Avedro, some of these Avedro people, they recommend 6.2 or 7.2 as the standard, not 5.4. And they go up to 10.2 joules from 6.2. But in standard, all other available systems, 5.4 we take is the highest necessary. Depending on the thickness of the cornea, as Coral has given, we can always change the energy they delivered. And I take into consideration uncorrected visual acuity. If uncorrected visual acuity are 6.9, 6.12, or better, sometimes 6.6, I use very less. I use 30% less energy. And if the accepting spectacle power is very small, cylindrical power, a lot of people, they don't accept, though there is a lot of keratoconus you diagnose and you think is advanced disease, the spectacle power, they don't accept much. They will be able to treat comfortably 6.12, and very small power. I use high power, they use, I use more energy. If the spectacle power is very less, I use less energy so that there is no hyperopic shift in the future. And as I've shown you the drawing, the thickness drawing is already given by Sporal. We can start with that and we can fine tune over a period of time. And the location, size and shape, I take this into consideration, inferior, central, area. 4 to 8 millimeters, I vary. Again, I don't use standard for 8 millimeters. And half circle, 3/4, 1/3, and full circle. The 3/4 and 1/3 circles and half circles we are trying to develop with industry. Maybe within 1 year, 6 months, they will come out with those. And for simple half, lower half is involved. I use a paper, cut glove paper, and soak it in riboflavin. I will cover the superior half, which is a flat cornea, which I don't want cross-link. I don't want it to become flat. And this is how during irradiation, so the superior uninvolved portion is protected. And another way of drug delivery is we use a riboflavin intrastromal injection with a fine 30G needle. But for this, you cannot use riboflavin readily available in the market. You have to use an injectable one, which you have to import from Switzerland. And immediately after that, the thickness will be increased from 300 to 600 or 800 microns. Very safe limit. Then you can do cross-linking and you can safely do the radiation. This is another one. Sometimes we do, even after injection, we cover the superior area. This is transepithelial. We can do it with the injectable technique. Then PTK is another modality, which is we found very useful. This is not centered onto the pupil. We have to decenter PTK onto the cone. We have to measure where is the cone center from the center. That's quite easy in topography. And the amount of ablation we do is from 55 to 75 microns depth, depending upon the stiffness of the cornea and the keratin. And the zone is again 5.5 to 6.5 millimeters. The transition also 1 to 1.5 millimeter, that depends upon the amount of flattening you need. The concept here is the epithelium is thinnest over the apex of the cone. So usually we measured it's coming around 35 to 40 microns. So if you do a 55 microns, it will knock off 15 microns of the apex of the cone, which will corrupt up to 6 to 7 diopters of steepening. The thinnest cornea is not the steepest cornea. That's what we found both from topography, pentacam, and from OCT studies of the cornea. Most of the times, the thinnest cornea is not the steepest portion. So usually you can do a good amount of tissue ablation at the steepest cornea, most elevated part, and make it flat. And PTK removes more tissue in the center than periphery as it is. So that also helps in removing the decentered PTK, remove more on the elevated, most elevated portion of the cornea. You can limit the another advantage here is you can limit the cross-linking only to the cone area. Non-cone area, which is already flat in keratoconus, you don't do cross-linking, it doesn't become much flatter. And once the Bowman's layer is removed, what we found, the penetration of B2 is much faster and the effect is much pronounced. That also helps. For example, this is the case. And what you do is you say measure the center of the cone and you measure from the center of the pupil. So here it is around 2 millimeters. You input that into your machine. I use a Visix. It will allow up to 3 millimeters of decentration. I don't know about the other machines. I think Schwind allows. I don't know about Allegretto, which allows so much decentration of the PTK. And for example, in this, we input x-axis 0 and y-axis -2. And this is a surgical procedure. So when you do a PTK, it's a decentered, as you can see. It is a conic area which is getting ablated. Wherever there is a, you can nicely see the zone. This is a big, the hyperfluorescence is the one still epithelium is intact. The one which is no epithelium intact is the dark area in the center. That is a conic area which becomes flat. The results are quite good. For example, this is the pre-op. This is the post-op in one patient. This is the pre-op where the cone almost is dropped down by more than 50%. And this is an irregular cone with an irregular bow tie. It becomes a symmetrical bow tie. There are many, many cases. I just don't want to waste your time. We do PTK nowadays. Almost 70% of our keratoconus, we do PTK and C3R. The key point is the more the duration of you apply UV, maybe the total energy is the same, 5.4 joules. You apply for 30 minutes. It gives more effect than you apply for 3 minutes. It doesn't obey the Bunsen-Roscoe law here in clinical practice. That's what proven by most of the studies have published also. So they settled somewhere now with the 9 milliwatt with a 10 for 5.4 So the best corrected visual acuity is decides my treatment plan. And I believe you carefully look, and I suggest you also look into the how much energy you need to use depending upon the best corrected visual acuity and uncorrected visual acuity. And corneal topography, location and size of the cone is important to study and apply the treatment to that area instead of globally applying to all area and giving 8 millimeters full zone of irradiance. The visual acuity is paramount importance, and it should be kept as a main parameter of success or failure of treatment, not on K-max. That's what I believe. And in case of doubt, do less than more. That's my philosophy. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you, Dr. Reddy. I think your ideas are truly innovative, and there are so many ways you've tackled a case of keratoconus where earlier we had thought was not possible to cross-link. I'm sure with the long-term results that you do come out and the number of patients that you study, there would be methods into dealing with these cases in the way you have dealt and in the way Dr. Mahipal sir has also shown that our limits are going to come down less than 400 microns. So there are a few questions on keratoconus, and Dr. Mahipal sir, this is for you. If a 31-year-old patient comes with keratoconus, would you cross-link the patient at the time of presentation, or would you would still like to say that you would like to see for progression? So you have to unmute yourself.
Yeah, basically there's another thing that I would want to know, whether the patient is a male or a female, and whether the lady has completed her family. So typically we can at times see a progression with the pregnancy, the hormonal changes that are associated in women. But as a patient ages, we all know that the cornea tends to toughen on its own. So it is necessary for you at this age that if you are having a documentation of a progression, then it is better. Otherwise, you can have a conservative approach. Once the patient is 30, 35 or 40 years of age, you need not actually cross-link. So I would prefer if the patient is young, and even if I don't have topographic evidence of progression, but I have evidence of progression even in the form of spectacles. That means that if I am having the prescription of a child, and in which the cylindrical power is increasing, or the in any of the eyes, and if the topography is showing a keratoconus, then I will go ahead and aggressively do a cross-linking at that time. But at a patient of 31 or 35, and specifically if it's a male and there is no evidence of progression, then you can wait. Then I will wish to have the topographic evidence with me to show progression.
Any other question any of the panelists has for keratoconus?
I'd like to ask one question to Dr. Reddy. What is the main indication of intrastromal
rigofluorescence? Basically, it is first we started for thin corneas, 400, 300 microns, like that, the corneas where there's less than 400 microns, and corneas to hydrate them to safe limit. But that you can adjust with the energy. It's not a big deal. You can always enlarge. Then decentered cones, if you have a only inferior cone, and if your superior part or pupil area is not involved, sometimes advanced cone in the other eye, and 6-9, 6-6 vision, they do have a cone in this eye and show some progression or no progression. You want to treat it, they want to get it treated. So we started using. To be frank to you, we can manage without intrastromal injection with other methods. It's just out of curiosity, that's all.
So I think before we finish this webinar, last word from you, sir, Dr. Mahipal, sir. What do you think is going to be the future of collagen cross-linking, especially in those cases, especially in thin corneas? And I think both of you, Dr. Reddy and yourself, dealt with it. But what do you think is going to come in the near future? And do you think that corneal transplantation for keratoconus one day will come when we won't have any cases of keratoconus to, transplant? Do you think that sort of a situation is going to come down the years?
So Dr. Namrata, the problem I would say in a keratoconus is that, as I mentioned during my talk, that the optometrists are still not on board. And I have still seen even some ophthalmologists saying ke bhai theek hai aap contact lens lagaiye and they just postpone the inevitable and they are pushing the patient towards the graft. I think if we have early diagnosis, what has also happened is that there is a significant increase in the availability of the topography machine. I think it has become almost like an essential tool that we have in all the practices which are decent. So the diagnosis has become early, and the important thing that is also needs to be stressed, especially for the postgraduates and undergraduates, is that the moment you smell that there is a difference in the keratometry even, and there is a cylinder that is appearing, especially in a young person, you should go ahead and put the patient on a topography. So if the diagnosis is early, then I particularly feel that there is going to be the advantage of being able to arrest the disease progress. And what has been shown is that the outcomes are excellent. The second thing is that theoretically, there is nothing stopping it from being repeated every. What is actually use of an excimer laser to actually work to smoothen the asymmetry of the cornea, maybe by removing up to 30, 40, 50 microns of the cornea, is also working very well with people. So that is something that if the asymmetry is removed, you will have good outcomes that is there. The intracorneal ring segments are also doing well. And what Dr. J.K. Reddy said is also being discussed very often, is that whether it is a global disease or it's a focal disease. And if you are looking at a focal disease and you are changing the amount of fluence that is being put at the apex versus what is on the side, you can actually have a significant reduction in the amount of astigmatism that is there, and you reduce the asymmetry level. A lot of these conic patients, after getting a cross-linking done, become amenable to glasses or contact lenses for an improvement in the vision. So I think the requirement for grafts will keep on going down over time. And there is nothing just now iffy about it that you can, cross-linking is something which is established. The other big thing that has happened is that if you have cross-linking, you have reduced the asymmetry and the power is very high. You can combine it with a intact segment, and you can also do an ICL. If the cone has not spilled over to the posterior astigmatism, causing a reduction in the vision. So I think there are so many modalities that are available for keratoconus that the number of patients who are undergoing, and now as you know well, we are doing the DALC, etc. So PK is pretty much in very bad cases where you have scarring, etc., that you are doing PK. But otherwise, the segmental having a lamellar grafts are something that are going to be used if at all patients are coming in late. So I think great advances have happened in the management of keratoconus ever since we were residents, and what it is today, I think it's a big difference that is there.
So thank you so much, sir. I would like to thank all the panelists for today's webinar, who have spared time, all the delegates who've been watching it over YouTube, Facebook, and our web browser, and have been posting questions. And we would like to thank Alargan for supporting this today. So we are going to have a lot more series of this walk-in patients, whether it is cornea or retina or refractive surgery, etc., so that people know how to diagnose these cases, treat, and when to refer. I think the most important is when to refer question. So thank you, everyone. And we do have another webinar at 6:15 p.m. And that is the Sri Ravi Shankar webinar titled Equanimity in Uncertain Times. And so we hope to see you again after 1 hour in that webinar. So thank you very much. Thank you. And we would also like to thank our audiovisual team, Mr. Sunil and Mr. Kripal and Rakhi, for helping at the back end. Thank you so much.
Thank you.